Act Midsummer. Ah, I see. Final Control is all about Christmas spirit this afternoon. Christmas spirit is starting early. I'm looking forward to that, Rebecca. Rebecca, will you sing me a Christmas carol every time I get something right? Every time I get a link right or something, can I have a Christmas carol?
Christmas carol related to every animal we see.
Yes. Rebecca wasn't listening. I did ask you a question, Rebecca. I said that you have to sing me a Christmas carol every time I get something right, like a link or something. But Viam has a better suggestion. He thinks you should sing a Christmas carol related to every animal. No, maybe not during the whole show, Bex. You might need to concentrate on other things. And also, I'm not sure what your singing's like. Is your singing terrible? I don't think it sounded that terrible. It can't be worse than Brent's. We can go back to that conversation we had ages ago about Rudolph the Red-Nosed Kudu. I can't remember why on earth we were talking about... Oh, I remember. It was because for some reason we were talking about reindeer and the fact that they were females and... I do vaguely remember. And Dasher, Prancer, and Dancer, and I remember. And then one of our lovely viewers very kindly did a picture of a red-nosed kudu for us. Although I'm starting to think that Waterbuck might be more Christmas-themed somehow. I'm glad you agree. I could somehow see them with bells on them. Rebecca would like to know what VM's favorite Christmas song is.
I was thinking about my favorite Christmas animal.
Okay, VM was distracted by thoughts of his favorite Christmas animal. A slender mongoose with a red nose. To the red nose. I don't know. What's your favorite Christmas carol, Rebecca? Hopefully it's not the one you just butchered in my ear. I can't remember the rest of the words. And I don't think Rebecca can either. Rebecca's singing Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. Told you, it has to be Rudolph the Red-Nosed Waterbuck. Or could you? Waterbuck, reindeer, water... Oh dear, syllables are just not right. I suppose kudu works better. Could do. We're now on to Rudolph the Red-Nosed Warthog. We have officially descended into end-of-year madness, I think. I think that's the only way we can describe it. A slight hysteria. You should have seen us treating Brent for our first aid drill. Brent is not an easy patient. There was lots of noise and groaning, considering it was a fake injury. There was lots of complaining about that. Ah, but a tale for another time. Hey, look! Do-do-do-do-do-do-do. It's so perfect because their noses are so heart-shaped. And on that note, I hope that all of our new viewers are intrigued. You're about to go into an actual proper live safari, and you will be doing that in roughly 10. So good. I'll see you soon.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Welcome to Africa, and more specifically South Africa. We're right next to the largest land mammal in the world. This is Safari Live.
by.
You are live.
Welcome to Bayside Elementary. This is your very own private African safari. Isn't this a wonderful way to spend a school class? Not only do we have big elephants, we got baby elephants. And this guy is probably only about a month and a half old and very, very cute. Following mom, keeping close. It's a lovely herd of elephants spread through the little river system here. Now, guys, send your questions through. I'd love to hear from you. And isn't this exciting? You get to come to Africa while at school. Now, an elephant can eat a lot in a day. A big male elephant can eat close on 500 to 600 pounds of leaves and grass in one day, and can drink 20 gallons of water. Now, there's no big boys here. This is a breeding herd, so it'll be made up of females, babies, and young males. Now, that's a young male just to the left of the mom and baby. Oh, he's a teenager, probably around 13 or 14 years old. Oh, maybe a little bit younger. Let's say 12 to 13 years old. And if he gets naughty, sometimes the females will give him a talking to. He'll get a timeout. And especially if he gets too rough with a tiny little baby like that. Oh, this is wonderful. I haven't had a really nice elephant sighting in a couple of days. It's rained here, so the elephants have spread out quite a lot. So great to have them back on Juma. Quite a nice herd. I'm just trying to see how many exactly. Are you 10? 10, maybe a few more, maybe 10 to 15 elephants spread out through there. Braden's wondering, is the big elephant a mom or a dad? I don't see any adult bulls here yet, Braden. So I'd say, those are two young boys. Those are teenagers, those two there. And the big elephant that the baby was following, that's definitely a mom. But as they move away from here a little bit, hopefully they're going to move into the open and we'll be able to see if there are any dads. I don't think so. Big dad elephants tend to spend a lot of time away from the breeding herds. It's too noisy, too busy, too many little kids and teenagers screaming and making noise. So, there we go. Look at him. He's found some nice fresh leaves there. Okay, yes, I think it's going to be very nice. They're going to walk below a waterhole where we can get above them. Who knows, they might even go have a drink while we're following them. This is really exciting. Isn't this amazing? You are watching this at the exact same time as me. Hello, Alyssa. Alyssa would like to know, do baby elephants ever go off and find food and water by themselves? Or do they always stay with their mommies? They always stay with their mommies. If they get lost from their mommies, it can be quite dangerous for them, Alyssa. Now, at this age, it's only really drinking mom's milk and not really eating. So when we actually found the little baby, he was having a snooze. So he doesn't have to worry about finding food or water. He gets it all from mom. As he gets older, he'll start eating more and more green things. Well, we're going to sit here and wait for the elephants to move out into the open. While we do that, let's go say hello to Byron, who's on foot.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Bushwalk. My name is Byron, and on camera with me this afternoon is Jandre. It's great to have all of you with us. Now, I know Brent has been talking about elephant, and he's been spending time with the elephants, and it's so nice to see them around. We haven't seen them for quite some time. It really, really is a wonderful privilege to sit with them. They're one of my favorite animals. Now, while we are on Bushwalk, we're going to be looking for some smaller little creatures, insects, maybe footprints, anything interesting that we can find while we're walking around, as opposed to being on the vehicles. Now, something I have found and that I've picked up for us to look at is one of the elephant's favorite little treats. And this is actually fruit from a big marula tree. And there's one or two around. I will show them to you shortly. But this fruit, at the moment, unfortunately, it's not ripe. They go a yellowish color when they do get ripe, but they're very, very tasty. And even we can eat them. They're very rich in vitamin C. So lovely nutrients for us. They've got a big pip inside, a very, very large pip, about this size, almost the same size as that fruit, a little bit smaller. But the elephants love feeding on them, and often they'll walk around, especially in summer when we do get all these fruit, they'll walk around and they'll stand under these big marula trees and they feed on the fruit constantly. And it's amazing to see how many they can start feeding on or putting in their mouth while they are eating. And it's lovely to see them feeding on it, and it's really something that they enjoy eating. There's actually a big marula just in the distance. You can see it over there. So that is a big marula tree, and there were a few others that we walked past earlier, and that's where I found the fruit lying on the ground. And it's interesting, the marula trees, what they do is, because the fruit is sought after by so many animals and by the elephant, obviously, they want to eat this fruit. So what the tree does, it's very, very clever. It actually drops the fruit before it becomes ripe so that the animals don't damage the tree just to get to the fruit, especially those big powerful elephants. So what they do is the fruit drops, and then the animals, and especially the elephants, can feed on these fruit just by picking them up off the floor. And speaking of some other fruit, I'm going to leave these marulas over there, but I've got some other little berries I'd like to show you. There's a beautiful tree called a white berry bush. Now you can see, look over here, and you can see all these little berries around on the tree. Now, also not quite ripe yet. This is called a white berry bush because these little fruits, these little berries do go white. And they are very, very tasty. And when you're walking through the bush, you can eat these too. But at the moment, they're not quite ripe. It's a little bit bitter when they're this yellowish color. So I'm not going to taste them now. Maybe, hang on, there's one or two that I can find that might be all right. There we go. You see, those almost ripe, that white color. So let me taste these and see what they taste like. Wish me luck, everyone. Still a little bit bitter, but much sweeter. Not too bad. But now, while we are out here on our walks, it is very, very crucial that you don't just eat any berries, because some of them can be poisonous. So you have to be very, very careful. I know which tree this is, so I know that I can eat these berries. But just remember, whenever you're walking around, don't just pick any berries and eat them, because some of them can be poisonous and can make you very, very sick or even kill you in some areas. All right, and speaking about all those elephants that Brent had earlier and that feed on these marula fruits, Brent's got some small elephants to show you.
Look at this. The little one is using his mom to scratch an itch. Yeah, mom's moving on. Now, you've got to be quite careful when you're this close to Eddie's. Now, you've got to watch their body language very carefully, but they're showing no sign of aggression. And I do know this herd quite well, so I've spent some time with them and I've seen that they're quite comfortable with our presence. Hey, Mom, how you doing? Now, it's very important to just keep very close to us, probably like 3 feet from the front of the car. But, and there's a little one. Hello, little monster. See, if you just stay nice and calm and watch their body language, you can get very close to Eddie's. Now, if you have to start your car, make a noise, it might make the elephants upset. So that's why I keep very still and I keep talking in a nice, calm voice. Isn't that fun? Now, Molly is wondering, what are some of the physical adaptations of an elephant? Well, let me just turn her on for you, Molly, so I can see what we're looking at. Well, let's look at the little one, since he's popping his head out. No, he's gone back inside. Well, of course, it's their nose. Their trunk is a massive adaptation. It's got a prehensile tip, which means it can work like a hand. It can pick things up, even little things. And their ears, being so big, they're like big air conditioners. They pump blood through there to cool down the blood so they can operate when it's very hot. And of course, their skin being so thick that they can just walk through thorn bushes. Them being so big that they can push down trees to get to leaves that other animals can't. So they've got lots of different adaptations. Okay, let's go catch up with her. She's moving again. Hi, Jackson. Jackson would like to know, how many leaves does a teenage elephant eat in a day? Well, I can't tell you exactly how many leaves, but I would guess in pounds, probably eats about 150 to 200 pounds of leaves in a day. We're just going to try to see where she's going next. Ah, Caden, how much water do baby elephants drink? That's a trick question, Caden, because they don't drink any water really. If they do, it'll be a very, very little bit. They get all their moisture contents from their mom. So they get their water from their mom's milk. Now, when they're a little bit older, they will start to drink water, but at this age, he's getting all his water from his mother. He might play in the water and he might try to drink, but he doesn't know how to use his trunk yet. And elephants use their trunk to collect water. And a big elephant can have up to 2 gallons of water in its trunk. Oh, see, she's right in front of the car. I'm just going to move again so we can see what she's up to. Looked like she was trying to get some grass out from underneath. There we go. So when other elephants or even she is pushed down these big trees, some grass grows underneath it and the other animals aren't strong enough. Look at that, she's going to move that branch so she can get to the nice fresh grass underneath. Now, she's the only animal that's strong enough to do that, and that's a very thorny tree, so some of the other animals won't be able to get to that grass. Oh, baby's having a drink. He's getting his water, Caden. Now, you've met Byron and you've met me, and sorry, I forgot to introduce myself earlier. My name is Brent and I've got Brian on camera, and he's got a snowman thumb because it is the Christmas season. There we go. But there's also one other person still yet to meet, so let's jump on board with Jamie.
Hello and a very warm welcome to the
Well, welcome back. This elephant's doing some incredible stuff. As you can see, she's bending right down and she's almost looked like she was putting her tusk into the ground. Oh, look at that. Isn't that amazing? Adriana's wondering if elephant skin gets dry in the sun. Not really, Adriana. They're incredibly adapted for being able to deal with amazing heat. Because they're so big, they have to eat all the time. So they will are one of the few animals that will eat in the heat of the day. Sorry, guys. I just need to be on the Game Drive radio talking to the other guys. Sorry, before there was Nkoma's Arethusa, there was one Satu Wanuna on Mvubu Road and another Wanuna somewhere, I'm not sure where, I wasn't out this morning. Okay, sorry, just letting the other Game Drive vehicles know what's around, telling them about the elephants and what else might be out here. Now, you can see how close the baby sticks to mom. It's where he feels, or she feels safe. and Mom's looking for all the tastiest leaves so she can produce nice milk for her baby. Oh, it's a little boy. Oh. Still not quite that good at climbing over things. Now, Stefano's wondering, is a baby elephant's skin thin like a baby human? Well, thinner than an adult elephant, but it's still much, much thicker than a baby human's. And a thorn that would rip through an adult human would not be able to break the skin on a baby elephant. They've still got very thick skin. Hello, Gavin. Gavin's wondering, do male and female elephants fight? Well, Gavin, sometimes, but normally it'll be a fight between a young male and a female. Normally the female's just chasing away. A big male elephant is so much bigger than a female, they generally try to avoid fighting. A big female elephant weighs around 6,000 pounds. A big male elephant can be 12,000 pounds, even a bit more than that, so almost double the size. So a female elephant doesn't try to fight with big males. Okay, they're disappearing behind the bush. Well, we got some more in front of us there, down in the dry riverbed. Now I'm hoping they're going to go for a drink in the mud wallow. Now Aiden's wondering, why do elephants use their trunks to drink water? Well, it's because they're so big, Aiden. If they had to try to put their mouth to the water, it would be very, very, very difficult. But their trunk is specially designed that they can suck the water up, and hopefully they will do that and will be able to see it. Okay, let's have a look. I'm just trying to see where the other ones are going. Are they heading towards the waterhole? It looks like they might go for a drink. So Aiden, we might get to see them using their trunk. She's not heading straight there yet. And it's a nice cool day, so she's probably not as desperate as she would be on a hot day. Stopping for snacks as she goes. We're going to sit here and wait to see if she goes to that water hole over there. While we do that, let's go see what Byron's found on foot.
That's wonderful that Brent has been able to see and watch those elephants. Now, I'd like to actually show you, and there's some signs that elephants have walked through here. Now, the elephants feed on trees and plant material. Now look at this, you see how this branch has been broken. Now this would have been from an elephant. Elephant probably breaking, trying to feed on some of the branches here. Now I'm just trying to see if I can't find some others where they've perhaps stripped the bark. See, what happens is sometimes the elephant like to feed on the bark of trees. The reason for that is because there's a lot of nutrients in the bark. So let me show you, just having a look around here quickly. Perhaps over here. Let's see. So Camden, you'd like to know what else do the elephants eat besides the marula? So generally all kinds of plant material, all the grass, the trees, the leaves of trees, the branches, some of the branches, and we can see over here what these elephants have done to this tree. Now they've pushed this whole tree over, isn't that incredible? And they've squashed it, and the reason for that is, and we can see it over here actually, what the elephants most likely did is strip the bark off of this tree, and they fed on the bark. So they feed on Well, a lot of different types of plant material, but you can see how they strip the bark. So what happens is this layer of bark is the layer that transports the nutrients. So what the tree needs to live and survive. The tree gets that from the soil, from the earth, and from the water. And that layer of bark transports all those nutrients and all that water to the rest of the tree. So what the elephants do is they feed on it because it's the tastiest part of the tree, including the leaves, but the bark, they like to feed on the bark because it's got all the nutrients that the elephants need. Just like we need our food, our vegetables and our protein, meat, or whatever we are eating for dinner or lunch, the elephants need certain types of food so that they can survive and that they can be healthy. So this is one of them, the bark off of trees. But as I said, they'll walk around, they'll feed on grass, they'll feed off leaves, they eat any type of vegetation that we get around here. Now, Brooke, you want to know, getting back to my story earlier about the different berries and that we get in the area, and you want to know how is it that the elephants know what berries are okay for them to eat. So generally, and Brooke, it's interesting, but the animals in this area, they are, the word we use is they're immune. So it means some of the berries that we get in this area doesn't affect them at all. So they are able to eat on just about any of the berries and the fruit that they get out here, and it doesn't affect them, it doesn't harm them. Some that might be a little poisonous for us probably doesn't affect these animals. They've got a different digestive system to what we have. So they can feed on some fruit and some trees even that might be a little bit poisonous and it doesn't affect them. But they know, and generally speaking, most of the fruit that we get in this area, so in this part of South Africa, most of it is fine for us to eat. And but again, only taste fruit or only eat fruit if you are with an expert that knows what fruit is around and what you can and cannot eat. It is very, very important. So if you're not sure, rather don't eat it. But in this area where we are, most of the fruit that the animals eat is fine for them to eat and is fine for us to eat. I'm going to see if I've got any other signs of some elephants. Maybe they fed on something else around here. But while I do that, Jamie's got a beautiful antelope for you to look at.
Okay, let us try that once again, and a very good afternoon to all of you, and welcome especially to the students at Bayside Elementary. My name is Jamie, and this afternoon, Viam is on camera with me, so he's the man behind the camera. And we've started off our afternoon by looking at one of my favorite antelope. And hold on, I'm just going to go forward a little, because I can see not just my favorite antelope, but it's actually my favorite, one of my favorite times to see one of my favorite antelope, because, oh, that's not a baby. That's an impala lying down. I thought perhaps it might be a little baby impala, but it is in fact just an impala that is sleeping or resting. Now, one of the reasons that this is one of my favorite times to see these animals is because this time of month is when impala have their babies. So around the end of November and the beginning of December, the impala start to all have their babies at the same time, and the whole reserve is filled with a tiny bouncing little ones. Now look at the impala on the right and have a look at how absolutely massive her belly is. And that's because she's very, very pregnant at the moment. And maybe some of you who've had younger brothers or sisters, and when your mom was pregnant with them, you might have had the opportunity to see when your baby brother or sister kicked, and you could actually feel the movement on your hand. Sometimes if you watch really closely on the bellies of impala, of pregnant impala, you can even see the babies kicking. And the reason for that is that an impala baby that is born has to be ready to run and to jump and to keep up with mom even after a few minutes after it's born. So they're not like human babies. Human babies have to be gently cared for. An impala baby comes out and is born, and within a few minutes starts to get to its feet, and by a couple of hours it can actually run and jump. That's how well-developed impala babies are and how ready they are to face the world. And that's because they have to be. If they weren't, things like leopards and lions and cheetah might actually catch them. Now, Mrs. Coughlin's class, there we go. You wanted to know what behavioral adaptations help baby animals or all animals survive. So the prey species. There's a couple of different types. One is... One is being very, very alert. So they've got very good senses of hearing and very good senses of smell. So they're always constantly listening. Plus, in a group like this, a group of impala will be together in a herd. And the reason that a herd helps is because you've got lots of eyes and lots of ears to help you. Some animals don't have a herd, though. Some of them live in secret alone and in very, very thick vegetation so that they aren't seen. And I can actually see there's another antelope at the back there. So we've actually got two different types of antelope here. And again, now we've got waterbuck adjoining the impala herd. And again, that just means that there are more eyes and more ears listening for potential predators. And then some of our bigger animals, are things like giraffe and buffalo, they're actually able to fight back against predators. So a buffalo can often turn the tables and attack something like a lion. And giraffe as well have very strong kicking ability. They're very big, big animals. So they can actually fight off the predators. But even with the impala being as pregnant as they are, and I mean that one female at the back, she's just here and she is so large and pregnant, that in fact all of them are. But despite the fact that they are as round as they are, they can still run exceptionally fast. Even though they are as pregnant as they are, Shaven, you can see she's starting to feel a little bit heavy and she's struggling just a little bit. She might even be nearly at the point where she's going to go away from the rest of the herd and have her baby. You never know. She's going to give birth in the next, I would say, in the next few hours, at least in the next 24 hours, probably around there. So the number of different prey animals have amazing approaches to protecting themselves. Porcupines have these huge quills to keep themselves safe. So we get porcupines here as well. And some of them are very, very smelly. Things like mongoose can be very stinky animals. Things like polecats or African weasels can be very stinky. And things like honey badgers can be very, despite their small size, they're very strong and they fight back with teeth and claws. So lots of different approaches by the different types of animals out here. Right, let us go and see what we can find. I don't want to run out of time before I've had a chance to show you something. I just want to watch that. Okay. She is moving off. I just wanted to double check that that female wasn't actually right now going to have her baby. So while I go on my way to visit the local waterhole and see what we can find there, let's go back across to Byron, who is on foot.
Now have a look at this, everyone. This is very, very interesting. There's signs of a little creature that has been living inside this hole, but it looks like it's been dug out. Hang on, I'm just gonna have a look in here. Sometimes tricky to get these things out. Oops. I hope there's still not one in there. There we go. Have a look at that. Now these are little scorpion pincers. Look at that. Two very, very large scorpion pincers. Let me put them around like this. Hold on. So that probably would have been the size of that scorpion. So the pincers there and the body possibly around this big. So a very big scorpion. And those are the pincers or the claws that we refer to. Now, this scorpion, I'm not too sure what actually killed it. We think perhaps a honey badger. Civet also feed on on scorpions. But as Jandre was also explaining that, and he's seen it before, where honey badgers are messy eaters. So they sometimes leave bits and pieces behind and they feed on the body generally. That's where all the protein and the nutrients are. and you can see this hole. It's clearly been dug out. The scorpion was dug out of this little hole, and then whatever it was got to eat the scorpion and left just these very big pincers behind. I'm trying to see, they still move. You can see, look here. If I pinch over there, you can see these little pincers probably would have been able to open a lot wider. I think it's probably stuck at the moment, but maybe about that wide, and then being able to catch any insects that they might be wanting to feed on, and then they'll close their pincers, grab them, and then eat them. But isn't that interesting? So even the scorpion that feeds on other insects, it also has predators, even with that very, very strong sting. You know, scorpions do have a nasty sting, and it can be quite venomous. Now, you might notice I've used the term venomous for scorpions, and I used the term poisonous for plants and berries. Now, let me tell you a secret. I'll tell you the difference between the two. Now, any plants or fruit or anything that we eat, if they are dangerous to us, they are called poisonous, because poison is if you eat something that is harmful to you. So that's poison. Whereas scorpions or snakes or anything that stings you or bites you, that is very, very painful and has and can be harmful to us, that is called venom. So scorpions have venom because they've got that very powerful sting, and that will be very painful. So anything that stings or bites you has got venom. If they've got poison in their body, that's called venom. And then if you eat plants or fruit or anything, it's called poison. So we're going to leave this hole and carry on, and let's head back to my friend Brent and see where he is.
So there we go. Some of the eddies have made their way down towards the water's edge. It's the mom and baby we've been following. And you can see mom's having a drink, sucking that water into her nose, putting it in her mouth. And baby's playing with the sand off to the side. So not even trying to drink at the moment. Now, at this age, the little one doesn't know how to use his trunk yet. He's still learning. So while mom's having a drink, he's having a good old play. Exploring, but not exploring too far away from mom. So we do apologize, the camera is having a slight malfunction. Now, Caden's wondering, when does a baby elephant leave its parents? Well, a female will stay with its mom, and a male will normally leave between 16 and 20 years old, depending on the herd it's with. It'll leave and normally wander quite close to the herd for a few years, and then after 20 they'll go off on their own, or sometimes in little bachelor groups or groups of boys. Hi Armando. Oh, look at him, he's having a rest now. Armando would like to know, do elephants migrate? Armando, they have seasonal migrations depending on rain and water availability. So they do, and this area, not too far, and sometimes as much as sort of 50 or 60 miles, but very seldom further than that. Oh, look at him, he's having so much fun. They're just too sweet, little Ellies. Everything around them is lots of fun, all new things to explore. Ian would like to know, how do elephants know when predators are coming? Well, elephants have got good hearing, good smell, and relatively good eyesight. So they might use any of those different things, but it's normally sight that'll set them off. And there's very few predators that'll tangle with an elephant, and only lions in certain parts of Africa, but in this part of the world, almost nothing tries to mess with an elephant. Yeah, that. It's like sucking through a big straw. Now, Colin is wondering how long elephants sleep for. Well, they don't sleep per se like we do. They doze, but normally not much longer than 20 or 30 minutes. The little ones can sleep for a couple of hours when it's very hot in the shade while the adults feed, but normally they don't sleep for very long at all, Colin. Gavin is wondering, are elephants becoming extinct? Gavin, in certain parts of Africa, yes, it is a big problem. But where we are, the elephant population is very healthy and very stable. There's about 17,000 elephants in the Greater Kruger National Park, and we probably, over a year, will see, on average, probably maybe between 500 and 1,000 different elephants. There we go, it looks like Mom's finished. Omar is wondering, when they have water in their trunks, can they still breathe? No, Omar, because they do breathe through their nose, but they will just hold their breath for a few seconds while they put water into their trunks. We do apologize, our camera seems to be having a bit of a problem, that's why it's going slightly out of focus every now and then. So it looks like they're heading away from the water hole now and probably going to continue on feeding. I think Brian and myself are going to go see if we can find some lions. They were around this morning, but I'm not quite sure if they've moved. So while we go look for some lions and let the elephants continue with their business, let's go see what Byron's up to.
Okay, everyone, now while I've been walking around, we're approaching a waterhole. It's not too far ahead of us. Now, we do need to be careful when we are walking towards water. And the reason for that is because we do get a lot of animals that might be close to the water. So what I'm doing is I'm constantly scanning, having a look and listening. Oh, there's little creatures I can see. I've just caught a glimpse of them. Some dwarf mongoose that have been running through the grass. I wonder if we're going to see any more of them. I think they've run off. They've seen us. I heard them giving a little alarm call. It's a sound that they make, believe it or not. Little mongoose, but they've run away, unfortunately. But as I said, we're constantly scanning and having a good look for any potential animals around the water. We do need to be careful. Also, just having a look for some tracks. Now, animals that might have walked through here already, and that's some elephant dung over here. And you can see it's very, very coarse. We've been speaking about this the whole time today, about the different plant material that they feed on. And you can see there's a lot of grass and bark and twigs all in this dung. This is very old though. This is completely dry. This was not recent at all. And that's all that elephant dung is. It's just grass and plant material. But it is something that you need to keep a lookout for when you're approaching water. So there would be elephants potentially near water, like Brent saw earlier. But these ones, fortunately, or the ones that left that dung, that's very old. So that would have been a long time ago. Sean, you wanted to know what are some of the things that a honey badger eats. Now, honey badger generally prefers feeding on little insects like the scorpions and that we found. They will also feed reptiles, even snakes, can you believe it or not? They will feed on snakes. They do also feed on honey. And there's a wonderful story with a honey guide or relationship. It's not a story, it does happen. There's a relationship with a bird called a honey guide. It's a beautiful bird. And a honey guide will fly around and it's got a specific call when it wants you to follow it. And it will take you to a beehive, and often the honey badger follows the honey guide, and the bird will take it to the beehive, and then the honey badger has got very sharp, powerful claws, and it will be able to dig and get maybe it's in a tree or something, it will be able to break that open, and it will get to the honey, and while it's feeding on the honey, the little bird also gets some honey, and will be able to feed on some of the bees. Isn't that incredible? Skin, and it's quite loose on the body, so the bees actually stinging it, it doesn't affect the honey badger. They're incredibly tough animals. So that's some of the food they can feed on, and generally most of it. They also feed on beetles, maybe dung beetles. We get these very big dung beetles at the moment. Hopefully we find them. I can try to show you. And that's what a honey badger would feed on. All right, let's just have a look here quickly while we're almost at the waterhole. Just want you to have a look around here with us. And does it look like there's anything here? Trying to see now. Just scanning around, making sure, double checking. No, and have a look, there is some water down here, just so you can see the water. Have a look. Now, we had a bit of rain the other day, but you can see the water's a little bit green at the moment, and no animals have come down to drink. I don't see any animals around here. But we'll continue looking and searching this area. And while I do that, let's head back to Jamie and see what she has found.
Oh, whilst Byron's waterhole might be empty, I've just passed one and I can see that something very big with something very big with very big feet came to have a drink at this particular waterhole. And I'm not going to get out because I actually happen to know that this particular animal is very close by. Now, it's hard for you to see there, but in the mud right there is a massive lion footprint. So those are the big paws of a lion as he went to go and have a drink. And now, just before we finish off with all of you and you have to go back to your normal school day, let's go and find this lion. He's somewhere just here, but you've all got to help me look for him. Got to keep your eyes peeled, it's windy. He's somewhere here, but I don't know exactly where. And I think his tracks are all pointing in this direction. I think he's somewhere here, so help me look. See if you can spot him before I do. He's gonna be hiding somewhere in the bushes. Now, apparently he is here with his lunch, which was something that he managed to catch, and that's one of the reasons why I know that he is here, is because I can see lots and lots of birds in the trees called vultures. There they are there. Let me try and slow down for you. There we go. There's the vultures in the trees. Now they're waiting for a chance to have their lunch, and that's because he's already there and he doesn't share. Ooh, he's somewhere here. He's somewhere just here. Let's see. I think I've spotted him. Let's see if we can put you. See if you can help me see him. He's still far away, but look closely. Let's see if we can spot where this lion is. Oh, and he's moving. There we go. He gave himself away. How perfect was that? Feet up in the air. I wonder if you all managed to see him as he rolled over. So there's our lion. Come, let's go closer. Let's go a little bit closer and see if we can see what he's up to. He's looking very sleepy, which is what lions are very good at. Lions are very good at looking very sleepy. Now, where is going to be the best way to get through here? I think we might have to go on a little bit of a journey. There we go. This might be the way forward. There we go. Gotta find my way through the big ditch that's in front of me before we can go to him. Hold on, it's gonna get bumpy. Whoop. Okay. Just hold on a moment. We're gonna see him shortly. I just need to work out how I can get across this big ditch that is in front of me. I see a way across the big ditch, I think. Oh, no, we can probably go through here. Hold on, everybody. Now we've got to hope that we don't get stuck. Otherwise, we're going to be in big trouble because then the lion is going to be there while we're trying to get out. Hold on, hold on. Everybody, hope we don't get stuck. Hey! And we're up and over. And hello to Hayley. You wanted to know whether or not there are any wildebeest where these lions are. There are often wildebeest here, Hayley. There's actually quite a big herd of wildebeest that lives in this area. I haven't seen any, Hayley, but that's probably because they know that this big male lion is here and they're hiding away from him. So yes, there are wildebeest around. I haven't seen them. They might be hiding from the big lion. Hold on. Oh. Oh. There he is. Hello, my boy. Just hold on one moment. I'm going to try and get you a good position to see him. Okay, hold on. We're just going to keep going round so that we can see his beautiful face. There we go, there we go, there we go. There we go. Hello, my boy. Sorry, hello. Hello. So there you go. There's our beautiful male lion. So we got here just in time so that you all could have a chance to see him as he snoozes away with one very fat belly. Isn't he beautiful with his big thick mane all around the top of his head? You can see the flies are really bothering him. Well, not bothering him, but they're crawling all over him. Sitting on his face, going up to his nose. I'd find that very difficult to stand if I were a lion. And then, of course, those massive big paws that left the footprints in the mud that we saw earlier. There we go. Isn't he magnificent? And he's doing what lions generally do at this time of day. They're nocturnal animals, which means they're awake at night and often, usually, asleep during the day. So he's probably been snoozing away for hours and hours over the last few, well, since the start of the morning. Hello to Stefano. You wanted to know if we are in the Serengeti Plains. Well, welcome, Stefano. And yes, while we do see, well, people do get lions in the Serengeti Plains, we're not there. So the Serengeti and the Mara and all of those areas are up in northeastern Africa, or eastern Africa. We are right at the bottom of the African continent in a country called South Africa. So we're in the southern part of the continent, and we're on the border, or almost on the border, between Mozambique and Botswana and South Africa. Sorry, not Botswana, Zimbabwe and South Africa. So we're right there. We're in South Africa at the moment. So it's a place called the Greater Kruger National Park. So whilst we also get lions and elephants and buffalo and wildebeest, it's slightly different where we are. And we don't have as many of the open areas. Michael, you were looking at elephants with Brent earlier, and now we're looking at this lion, and you want to know, do elephants fight lions? Yes, they can. They often, Generally, the lions don't stick around to try and have a fight with an elephant, but elephants very often chase away lions. They don't like the way that they smell. They don't like having them around. You saw that tiny, tiny baby with Brent. Well, the lions could potentially catch that baby, but with the whole elephant herd protecting it, they don't stand a chance. So yes, elephants do chase lions, and in some places in Africa, lions can even hunt elephants. Tyler, you've asked me a question I don't know the answer to. How does the lion manage to sleep with all of those flies on it? I don't know. I think he's just used to it, because I can tell you something, I wouldn't be able to sleep if there were flies crawling all over me. There's not too many on him. There's one or two crawling around. But look at him. He's basically fast asleep. He's quite happy with the flies all over him. I wouldn't be able to stand it. But very good question. I can't tell you how he's able to. I think it's just because he's used to it. Well, unfortunately, it is time for us to say goodbye to all of the kids at Bayside Elementary. I hope you've had fun and that the rest of your school day is exciting, as exciting as this part has been. So from myself, Viam, that Birmingham boy, and the entire Safari Live team, have a good rest of your school day, and we hope to see you again soon. Bye-bye, everybody. Regular viewers, welcome back and thank you for bearing us with us on the beginning of the sunset safari. Just a quick reintroduction for those of you that have just joined. My name is Jamie, and this afternoon I have Viam on camera with me, and we are coming to you live, in our case, from Cheetah Plains Game Reserve in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. And what we've just been doing for the last however long it was, since 3 o'clock, I think it was 45 minutes, what we've just been doing is a school drive with some elementary kids from sort of around the ages of about 8 to 9. So that's what we've been up to. So thank you for bearing with us. You can send through your questions and we will start taking them now. And you can do that on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. And what a wonderful thing that the kids had a chance to see our Birmingham boy. I didn't even get a chance to really go into introducing him or anything like that. We were a little bit pushed for time, but isn't it fantastic that kids are now at the point where they can get onto the back of a safari vehicle, quite literally, well, not quite literally, but you sort of imagine they're on the back of a safari vehicle and be introduced to cats like this. And that's why we prioritize their questions, because of course, kids are the future of conservation. And the more they learn to love and connect with moments like this, the better. The one thing I avoided pointing out to them, since we didn't want to make any of them feel queasy before their school break, is that this male lion does actually have a dead buffalo in front of my vehicle. I'm just trying to see. Unfortunately, it's a tricky position that we're in. I can't see how much he's eaten, but he does have a buffalo kill there. Not much. From what I can see, I think he's eaten all of the organs, and that's it. So that does explain the presence of all of the vultures and the many, or the very full belly. Hey boy, you're having a good snooze. And I just have to share with you that on our way here, we passed Tundi in the Mulwinini, and I'll explain a bit more in a moment. Now I just have to think about. I just have to think about moving. Sorry, there was a fly going up my nose. I'll explain to you a little bit more about Tundi, but before I do, Emre, you wanted to know about the social dynamics of lions and whether or not they're basically, are they developing? Do they change or show improvement from generation to generation? And do they, or have they in sort of in any way invented a new thing? Hello. It's a very, very good question. A very good question. And just bear with me because I want to give you a proper answer, but I also just want to shift out of the way. How's it? How are you? Hold on, I'll shift for you. Hi, guys. Hold on one moment. I'm just going to shift back a little bit. so that... Oh, sorry, that was a bit too fast. I'm going to try and see if I can get a view without blocking. There we go, Vim. Is that all right for you? No, now he's got a branch in his face. Okay, let's just settle for this for now. So that the other guests can have a chance to take their photographs. And I'm just ducking down out of your way. It's a really, really good question about the social dynamics of lions and if they've improved. Because, of course, the thing is, they have to adapt almost constantly to different conditions, different trying conditions. Our lions have just come through a drought, and the Sticks, who contracted mange, none of their cubs survived, but the Nkuhumas, 6 out of the 8 cubs survived, and actually all of them, all 8 cubs, actually shook off the mange and it was getting better. So that's an example of evolution at work. Not evolution, but essentially the strengthening of the gene pool and the survival of the fittest cubs. And naturally, as the Nkuhumas reproduce, those genetics will be continued and propagated, the fact that they can survive those sorts of diseases. Let's just shift a little bit around. Sorry, everybody, I've got to just do this. I've got to get around. Anyway, I'm just going around that side. We can admire his belly for a bit while we wait. And perhaps we shall admire his bottom. Okay, this will do for now. We will shift around a bit later. So I'm just making some space for the other guests in the vehicle. It's a bit of a tricky spot he's found himself in. I'm trying to think if there's any other examples. I mean, lions are always constantly adapting. They're not an animal that's going to learn to use tools. That's not what they're built for. It's not in the way that they work. And in a way, they've achieved an almost, not perfect, but a very, very good design. Is there a way in which they have adapted or changed? I'm going to think about it some more, and I'll get back to you on that answer, because it's a very, very good question. And what I'd love to do, what I've always wanted to do, is go back in time a couple of hundred years just to see how things have changed. And speaking of diseases, Justin S., you want to know if lions are prone to any sort of cancer. Not that I know of, in terms of one cancer being more likely than another. However, they can get cancer. I know that they can get cancer. Usually you find, of course, that it's the older lions that will get something like a growth. And very often, of course, they perish before you even realize, or without you even realizing, what it was that struck them down. Because life out here is very unforgiving. They can't just check themselves into some kind of hospital or get treatment in any way. So when they do get something like a cancerous growth, it often kills them relatively silently and without us really realizing exactly what it is that's got them. So yes, lions can get cancer, but it's unusual. It's not common to see them with it. In fact, most of the animals out here can get cancer in some form or another. Often it's just benign growths, so tumors that are completely benign. But you do get the odd instance of strange things occurring. He's snoozing away. I'm just wondering. I'm just checking all of the vultures in the trees. I'm just thinking that perhaps this close to Kruger we might see a white-headed vulture. But it looks as though we've just got lots and lots of white-backed, which we're happy to see as well. Although that one is, I like the idea that that one's attempting to pretend to be a white-headed vulture. With one ridiculously fluffy feather on the top of its head. Very beautiful in their own way. Okay, maybe not beautiful, very striking in this afternoon light and with these stormy grey skies. We're going to spend a little bit longer with our Birmingham boy to see what he gets up to. In the meantime, let's go see how Byron's stroll through the bush is going.
Wow, so there are lions around. Jamie's with the lion and Brent's had the elephants. That's fantastic. We're still walking around, just enjoying the walk. It's a nice, beautiful, cool afternoon. I'm trying to see if we can't find other tiny, tiny little creatures around here. Let's have a look. There's some more old elephant dung. There's a little millipede that's curled up. Have a look at that. I wonder if it's perhaps feeding on something here. Let's see if it decides to move. No, seems pretty comfortable there. Possibly trying to hide. It is out in the open a little bit. It's got to be careful of certain birds and that. But generally the millipede is quite safe with that hard exoskeleton. You can actually see it over there. Very, very hard exoskeleton to protect it. And now there's a very large termite mound just ahead of me. I think what I'm going to do is walk over, stand on top and just glance around. And it's usually a great place for a good vantage point to have a look if there are any animals close by. And also, you never know, we could potentially bump into something around the termite mound. You know, the other morning after all that rain, it was about a week ago, I think we had an interesting blind snake. So there could be snakes in that around here too. We do have to watch out for that. But let me have a look what we can find. This is a very old termite mound. And this is a lovely vantage point. Really great view from up here. Perfect to have a look for animals. I'm just trying to have a look. There's a little hole here. Sorry, I can hear a funny bird calling, but I don't know what that is. It sounds almost like a sick Egyptian goose. And I can't see it. It's quite far into the bush and it's not a clear call. But one bird we might be able to hear is the woodland kingfisher. Or you might be able to hear. Very close to us. It's in these trees, in these large marulas, not far from us. But I can't spot it. Very difficult to spot. So JJ, you asked, do birds often get sick? So I'm not sure if the goose is sick. I'm just saying that the call sounds like it's a goose that's got a bit sick. I don't think they often get sick at all. It's just a very strange sound that I can hear. There's a spider hunting wasp flying around us. They're very difficult to focus on. I'm trying to see if it will land somewhere. Usually they just fly and they look for potential food, and we know they do feed on spiders. So JJ, no, the birds, they may get some sicknesses at times, but that was not, there goes that spider hunting wasp, but that was not very difficult to try and follow. It's almost impossible. But I'm not sure what that was calling in the distance. Very strange sound, not one that I'm used to. I haven't heard it before. And then now we can have a look. There's an entrance to this termite mound over here. Now I'm not sure what would use this. It could potentially be a home of a snake. This doesn't look like an active termite mound at all. The soil is very, very hard and solidified on the outside. And this hole is very big. And I can see that termites have not been working on this for a very long time. So perhaps mongoose or maybe snakes have used this as a little home. Just have a look. There's another little entrance here. Same thing. No, not active at all, but potentially other creatures may be using it. And that's a wonderful thing about a termite mound, is that a lot of different animal species can use an abandoned termite mound once the termites have moved out. Everything from warthog, aardvark, hyena, wild dog, snakes, mongooses, that is the plural for mongooses. So a lot of different animals will use this. porcupine. Don't forget the porcupine, they'll also use it. Anyway, I think we're going to continue off of the termite mound. I can't see anything in the immediate area from here. So we're going to continue our walk and see what else we can find. Follow me down here. Gendre, mind your step. It's a little steep. We might have to run down. So Kat, you wanted to know if spider hunting wasps sting humans. I'm sure they do, Kat. I don't know of anyone that's been stung by one. I'm sure it would be very painful, but I'd never heard of anyone being stung, and touch wood, I haven't, knock on wood, I haven't been stung yet, so I'm not sure. But look, if it does sting you, I'm sure it's pretty painful. I can hear some oxpeckers ahead, but can't see anything in the distance. Maybe some impala. All right, we're going to try and move through this area. It's a little bit thicker now, so I'm just going to concentrate a bit more and see what else we can find in here. While I do that, let's head back to Brent and get an update from him and see what he's up to.
Oh, welcome back. Now, we have given up on our search for those lions. I went to where James had them this morning, and I can't see any sign of them. They might still be somewhere in that block, but I'm quite interested to see if the Nkumas, because they could be getting hungry by now, might start moving back towards Juma. So I'm also, and also when I left Karula, she was heading to the direction of Impala Plains. We hate corrugations, don't we, Brian? We hate them. Oh, and yes, we forgot, because it was a school drive earlier, but the killer bees are back! Oh, killer bees! Let's see what the killer bees can produce on their first afternoon back together. Remember, this is live, hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, questions at wildearth.tv if you'd like to ask us some questions. And we're going to go find out exactly where the incredible Nkuhumas are. And also, Alex is installed. Alex, the Russian genius tech department, has installed me a new radio antenna on the opposite side that I now, hopefully, am going to be able to speak to Arethusa. Let us see. Now, see, it's confusing. I've got one radio out of the way. There's two radios out of the way. And oh no, oh dear, oh dear. Three radios! Oh, and as you know, James is back, but he's taking some guests from that geo out, and I'll be doing the same tomorrow. Jamie's on Cheetah Plains. Negative, I'm following up on Nkumas at the moment. Alright, sorry about that, I'm back. So there we go. One, two, oh no, I've lost the blooming radio. Yeah, there it is. Afternoon stations. Brent, looking for an update for Safari. Do you hear that, Brian?
I didn't.
That's because there was nothing to hear. No, I'm only joking. We might still be a bit far away. Let me get a bit closer. And before I say it was not working, Alex will hit me with a stick. But I know that we're quite close to this area. And sorry, I just didn't catch that. Too many radios. So wrong. I'm sorry, someone from the Netherlands, I think it was Sarah, who would like to know how much rain we need. Gad, sorry, Gad. I just heard as I heard the beginning, and then all the radios started speaking to me at the same time. So yes, it's working. But the cat, how much rain is going to be needed to fill up all the dams and water holes? It's difficult. I mean, if we get one really big rain, 70-80 mils, it should fill up a majority of it. But often those big rains in one go aren't really great. Prefer to have sort of 20 mils a week to fill, and then it also gives the topsoil a chance not to wash away, because the grass will grow slowly enough to hold it together. But yes, I'd say between 70 and 100 mils should fill the dams in a single sitting. Okay, now I know the Inkhumas were lying just inside Arethusa. Brian, did you see them this morning?
Yes.
You did. Are we in the right neck of the woods?
Yes, we are.
Okay, good. We'll just keep on trundling very slowly. Now, the other reason is nearly lost my hat. The other reason is that Queen Karula headed into this area last night, but there's no sign of her going south today. So there's always a possibility that she's made a kill in the block between Impala Road and Zoe's Road, and she might have headed off to collect the cubs during the day. So very good chance of that. So we're going to have a squiz around there once we get an update on the Inkhumas. Everyone go, Inkhumas come west, and hopefully they just walk across the road in front of us and we don't need to worry about radios and the like. It is quite a nice cool afternoon. I'm saying, judging by the multiple car tracks into the bush, that the Inkhumas were here at some point. Just there. Could you see them from the road?
Yeah.
Okay, well, we don't know if they're still here, so I'm just going to meander a bit forward. Oh, wrong radio. This is any station in the west coughing. Mysterious mystery. Maybe they came back to Juma. Let's keep looking for tracks. Termite mound. Is it? Yes, indeed, a termite mound. Yes, I'm on the correct channel. Wouldn't that be embarrassing if I was on the wrong channel? Any station in the west copy me? On that note, we're going looking for leopards. No, I'm quite sure. I will get an update as soon as I can. Well, the Bake would like to know how we tell all the radios apart. That one, with a sticker or a piece of white gaffer tape, that is for Arethusa or Cheetah Plains Game Drive. That one, that's got a screen on its face, is for Juma Game Drive comms, if you're on the right channel. That one, with no screen on its face and no white stickers and a nice orange button, is for Final Control. Okay, so no sign of the Inkhumas just yet. I'm just making sure there are no tracks crossing back towards Juma. Well, we're going to go look for Queen Karula in the meantime. I think she might have wandered towards the Baranites tree. Okay, while we keep checking carefully around here. Let's go see what Byron's up to on foot.
And quickly have a look at this, everyone. We've got a lilac-breasted roller flying over there. I wonder if we might see a display. Not. Have a look. Oh, there we go. There goes one. Have you got it, Chandra? It's dipping, and there it flies down. Very tricky, but it's amazing to see them do the aerial display, the lilac-breasted rollers, as they fly. They stop flapping their wings, and they do this loop. They go dip, and they loop, and they do two or three of those, where they just dip, and dip, and dip. And then as they come down, they then do this beautiful twisting motion where they don't flap their wings, they just do this and they come down almost like a fighter pilot would fly a plane down. Well, that's how I imagine it. Incredible display, and that's where they get the name roller from. Just having a look while we walk around now. I heard some other birds up ahead, some crowned lapwings. Now, why I'm curious about them, because they were on the ground, and these are ground nesting birds. And they do make a noise, but if you get any close, or if you get close to their nests, what they will do is just watching the sticks over here, they'll dive bomb and they'll try and get you out of the area, out of the terrain, or close to where their nest is. Lovely view from up here. We're on a bit of a crest area at the moment, so you can have a look. I mean, we can see most of Juma from here, actually. It's a beautiful, beautiful landscape. And one of the best views, I'm sure, watching a sunrise from here would be really incredible. And perhaps we should try that one morning. Let's try to get out a little bit earlier and get into this area as quickly as possible so we can try and watch a sunrise from here. I will remember that. I will try to do that maybe tomorrow morning. There we go. There goes the crowned lapwing. Let's see if it flies back. You might be able to hear it. Hang on. Can't see it now. Let's listen. Well, there it goes. And it's not calling, but it was. Let's have another look. See if we do get a bit closer. It keeps landing just up front, so let's see if we can't find where this bird is sitting. Usually they don't sit on the nest though, and it's literally a little scrub, a little area where the bird basically not quite a hollow, but a little area of soil where it will scratch it up and maybe build. So what they'll do is this, and a little egg, and the eggs, but the eggs are incredibly well camouflaged. And so where they get the eggs, but they'll usually run around, and then if close, they'll chase. We'll continue towards that bird. Let's head back to Brent, get an update from him while I do that.
Welcome back. So far, no sign of any tracks of the Queen of Juma, but we are checking very carefully. Now, what we need to do, what Brian correctly told me to do, but I said, no, we'll just do it when we get to the Balanites tree. No rush, you know. All the time in the world out here in Africa. But now, obviously I've been caught out because you're back and I haven't done what I was supposed to do. So, I'm going to have to do it. You're just going to have to bear with me. I wanted to do that so I could also have a quick look around here for tracks of our beloved queen. But we need to put the aerial down since we are back on Juma. We're not traversing Arethusa and places as such. So you can have the best unobstructed view. Brian, may I please have a piece of gaff tape? No problem. Yeah, so Brian was correct. I should have done this when I was off air, but I was like, no, just wait till we get to the Balanites tree. Well, at least we waited till we got to the Balanites tree, but you caught me unawares. beautiful tree. That tree and I have some history, of course. You can hear Brian laughing. I fell from quite high out of that tree once, but fortunately, I landed as nimbly as a cat. Not quite.
To a degree.
I managed to land without breaking any bones, which for me, or for any of us, is as nimbly as a cat. There we go. Lovely twisted trunk of the Balanites morgami, the torchwood tree, or the greenthorn. Oh, yes. We did a first aid drill today. Rebecca tried to kill me about 5 times. I was the patient. So some of us have done quite a lot of first aid drills and actually had to manage incidents over the years. Oh look, we found a bushwalk as well. He's not very good at hiding. You can see, there he is. Do we have anything to throw at them? Oh dear, we have nothing to throw at them. Standing by, Dave. Hello, Orbs.
How did you see us?
Copy. Hi, thanks very much, Dave. I'm on my way. I'm very close.
I'm Byron. We're on bushwalk.
Having a good time?
Very much, sir.
Okay, copy.
We're going to continue our bushwalk.
Here we go. Bye!
Bye!
Sorry, there's... So there we go, we found the bushwalk. We were talking about the first aid drill. Yes. Yes. So generally, we're trying to get a lot of the staff who haven't done as many first aid drills, we're trying to get all to the same level. So I ended up as the patient again. The last time, they did kill me very quickly. Well, VM, Rebecca and Geraldine did a sterling job at murdering me. I mean, I think I was probably better off trying to recover from my snake bite by being left alone than having first aid done. But this time, no, it was much, much better. Apparently, patients are supposed to be quiet when they die. I wasn't. This time, I had a broken leg concussion and possible spinal injury. So I was allowed to be vocal while I was being treated. Yes, Eggsy managed to re-break my leg in about 4 places. Brian said, "I'm sorry, you're going to die," and walked away. No, but it was quite fun. It always is fun, and it's always good to learn while having fun. But yes, I definitely feel more safe than I did last time. But I think I will be my own incident coordinator if anything does happen to me. But yes, no, we did our offer. They managed to get me on a spine board. And there we go. Final control says, just because they killed me again, it doesn't mean they don't love me. Well, thanks for that, Rebecca. But of course, I mean, it's something that a lot of you guys might not realize, that out here, you need to be, to a degree, self-sufficient when it comes to that type of stuff. Of course, we have a provider we have paramedics based in the reserve, but sometimes it can take them an hour or plus to get to where you are. So you need to be able to have those skills to stabilize someone in a dangerous situation till either a helicopter or all the paramedics can arrive. And it's also knowing when to make the call, whether you need a helicopter now or you need... or you can stabilize and wait. It's not life-threatening. As I've had to deal with some interesting injuries over my time in the bush, but in terms of first aid, I've patched up crocodile attacks in Tanzania. One of our waiters got grabbed by a crocodile in the river. And lucky for him, it wasn't the biggest crocodile. And his friends were holding his one arm, and the staff were holding his other. And one other person rushed off to find me, and I managed to get there and get into the river and shoot the crocodile and then take him out and administer first aid. He was very lucky, but it did cause massive damage in his upper bicep and forearm. So, I mean, that smack is incredibly powerful. I think it's about 800 pounds, whatnot, that downward force of a crocodile snap. So quite often, and then they don't have cutting teeth. They don't have cutting teeth, they just hold on and then they grip. But he was very lucky, he was sitting in the river where he shouldn't have been sitting at dusk. And that crocodile obviously thought he was a bit smaller than he was. And fortunately, his friends were close by to help make sure that the crocodile didn't take him into the deeper water. Well, I'm going to go check the southern boundary again, see if there's any sign of Queen Karula. Hi, Cola. Cola says, as a guide, what level of first aid do you need? It's a minimum of a level one, which is basically the stabilization and stuff of a patient. I have a... Well, it's a bit different, the one I've got. I've got a military paramedics course, which is just around a level three. Theoretically, I'm able to help in childbirth, but I hope it never comes to that. But also, I've done probably far more extensive courses over the years because I've had to live in places that are far, far, far away from help. And if something happens to you in the rainforest of Gabon or the Southern Salu Game Reserve, you're looking at 5 to 6 hours before anyone can get to you. So I'm able to put on drips and do all sorts of funny things like that. All good skills to have, but hopefully those skills that you never want to use. Now, while we continue to check if Queen Karula has made a dash across our southern boundary, let's go see Byron, who's at the beginning of something.
That is right, Brent. It is the beginning of something. Something amazing. The termites have started building a little bit of a tunnel over here. So the start of potentially a termite mound. Isn't this amazing? Look at them all working around there. All the workers packing and building the soil. And that's one of the wonderful things you can expect after rain. And we did have a bit of rain last night. And you can see these termites are all out, busy packing away, trying to build the tunnel. Now, I'd like to show you something. There are some little soldiers around. You can see one or two over there with those very large pincers. And I'm going to see if I can show you something interesting. I'm going to ask Jandre if I can borrow a piece of his hair. Let's see. Nice long... Oh, is that so? All right, let's have a look and see if I can get it done for you. Okay, there we go. So there's the strand of hair. You're able to see that. Now watch how sharp these little pincers are. Now watch this big guy here, this little soldier. Come on. Watch this one maybe. He doesn't want to bite the right way. Hold on. He's not interested. Hang on. There's one over here. This is not working very well. There we go. Come on. Did you wash your hair today, Jean-Ray? Seems a bit stronger than usual. Hang on. Come on. There. Bite. It's really not going my way today. Oh dear. Bite the hair. It's not working, and that's okay. I'm going to leave them because they clearly don't want to cooperate today. It's really, there's nothing you can do about that. That's nature. So lovely to see them though, and they're carrying on. They're building They're not fazed by us, fortunately, and maybe that's why they didn't want to bite that strand of hair. But they do have incredibly sharp pincers, and if they do bite the strand of hair, it splits it so quickly. It's just interesting to see how finely they can cut something that is bothering them and disturbing them, and those little pincers can leave quite a nasty bite. They're very, very sharp, and they can draw blood if you get a finger too close to some of the termites, especially those soldiers. Jean-Ray knows all about that. It happened to him not too long ago.
Demonstrate.
No, I won't demonstrate. You know, we did first aid today, as Brent was telling you about. So all about safety first. I don't want to try and tackle a termite. We thought we'd head into this area where Brent was looking for tracks of Karula, just to see if we could give him a hand, but we unfortunately haven't seen anything yet. But we'll keep our eyes peeled. You never know, we could potentially find tracks of her and try and help Brent track. But while we're walking, we'll still be able to have a look for any small little creatures, and especially under these, like, oh, there's a lizard. He was just outside. Let me see if we can get him. He might be under the log, Jandre. I don't know if you want to try get from that side. He was moving very quickly. Let's see. Oh, where'd he go? He ran off. He went out there. No. Oh, there he goes. Oh, look at that. I didn't even have a look at him. It was so quick. Don't know what it was. Just a lizard of sorts, I'm not sure. Interesting. Lovely to see. Nice to see these little animals running around, little reptiles. But I'm not sure what it was. It was a little bit too quick for me. I have to work on my speed spotting. Alright, now Jamie had those lions earlier, and it sounds like they're busy feeding. Let's go have a look.
He is indeed tucking into his buffalo meal, and for those of you that are new to these safaris, and perhaps for whom this is a little bit too much, you can sort of go and make yourself, as James describes it, perhaps go and make yourself a cup of tea, and then come back if you're not into the gory things. Our lion is currently tucking into his buffalo meal, quite happily munching away. So he was just sleeping off quite a full belly, and he is now going about the task of what looks like eating. It looks like he's eating the head. So I was right about the fact that he has nibbled away all of the sort of the internal organs, and those of course are the best part of your average buffalo kill. Now he's using that rasping tongue to lick away the flesh from around the bones. And we're not going to stay with him for too much longer, just because there are other vehicles that want to come into the sighting, but we'll spend as long as we possibly can before we move out, and we'll go off in search of other things, perhaps some cheetah on the open area of Cheetah Plains. What do you think, boy? But it is an absolute pleasure to see Nsugu once again. It has been a long time since we last saw him, a very long time. And generally, we actually don't see all that much of two of the four of the Birmingham boys. Tino and Mfumo spend their most amount of time with us and around us and with the Nkuhuma pride, whereas Nsugu and Nena, they have a tendency to roam a little bit further away from our traverse area. They're often in Chitwa, occasionally even down into Mala Mala, and generally just more on the eastern fringes of the Birmingham boys' territory. And that's not to say that they don't come together every now and again, although I can't think of the last time we saw all four boys together. Can you, Viam?
Years ago.
It feels like years ago. It was a long time ago. Sorry, hold on one moment. Sorry, guys. Hold on one second. Okay. Thank you, Andrew. He's got it under control. I've been trying to figure out exactly how big this buffalo is, but Judy Starr and Roger, you wanted to know whether or not he took down this buffalo by himself. Yes, I think he did. In fact, I'm almost certain that he did. The Birmingham boys, of course, have a reputation as being serious buffalo killers. They have been known in the past. Let me just try and go backwards. Oh, hold on. As I said that, he sort of came back into... No, let me go back a little. Sorry, everybody, making you motion sick here. Let me just go back a tad. It's a very tricky position that we found ourselves in, or he's found us in, or we found him in, or something like that. So yes, the Birmingham boys have quite the reputation as very well-equipped buffalo hunters. Now, there is this reputation that male lions can't hunt, or that they are lazy hunters. They're not lazy hunters. And a lot of the studies have been based off very, very skewed science. So yes, social hunting is often more effective. It has a higher success rate. The females will hunt alongside the males when the males are around. And yes, they'll probably have a slightly higher success rate because there's lots of them. But the fact that the male doesn't necessarily always catch the kill doesn't mean that he's not a vital part of that whole process. There are statistically always going to be more females than there are males when they are hunting. So even the research papers that sort of claim that the females are more successful hunters, they're statistically more likely to be because there's more of them. And yes, the male lion is a little bit slower and he gets a little bit hotter than the females because he's got this big head of hair that will heat him up. And he's got a, but he does have an extra 100 kilograms at least on a female. And that means that just in sheer power, in terms of sheer power, absolutely a male lion is capable of taking down a fully grown buffalo all by himself. And very often they play a pivotal role when a pride is taking down something like maybe a buffalo, although we know the Nkumas can do that on their own. Oh boy, which way are we going? Oh, look at that power. The strength of that lion. Let's go over to Byron and see what he's got.
It's a female boomslang. Wow, look here everyone, we've just found a snake. And now have a look, it's a beautiful snake. It looks like it's a female boomslang. That's exactly what it is. A beautiful female boomslang. Can you see her up in the tree? Oh, wonderful. I get so excited because I love snakes. I really do. And you can see her clearly sitting up there. And look how she's puffed her neck up a little bit. That's typical of a boomslang to try and make themselves a little bit bigger. So she obviously got a fright with us walking past. She was down on the ground. You know, she was on the ground, and as we walked past, she shot up into the tree, incredibly agile. Now the boomslang, the name boomslang directly translated, it's actually a Dutch or Afrikaans word, directly translated means tree snake. And for exactly this reason, incredibly fast climbers, very agile. But now the... wonderful thing. Oh wow, oh my word. Aubrey is on walk with us and he's got incredible eyes. Now let's leave that snake there for a second and I just want to point at something. Owl. Now, please don't get confused with this owl and the Scops owl, the other little one that we get in this area. This is called the white-faced Scops owl. It's much larger. How it's walking, it's trying to just hide away from us. Now they are mainly nocturnal and I think that's why it's choosing not to fly away. Isn't that face incredible? I hope some of our viewers back home are getting a lot of screenshots of this, because this is not something we see often, and I'd love to see it when we get back to camp. This is really beautiful. That face is incredible. I'm so excited. I don't really know what to say. The Boomslang is still off to the left, but I think let's stick on that owl for a bit, because it's not something we see often. The Boomslang hasn't moved yet. I'm just trying to have a look. Aubrey said he thinks he saw another owl. My word, that is a Scops owl. So we have a white-faced Scops owl. Now have a look at this. Two different species of owls. They're just to the left of that one. You can see another one hiding there. And where that bird's just jumped, just off to the left, there's another one. No, you know what, just having a look on close inspection, they're both white-faced Scops owls. That's a little bit bigger than the Scops owl. I'm just having a look. That Boomslang is moving now. There's so much going on here. I don't know what to show you. It might be around this side. I'm just going to have a walk around here to have a look. There's two owls. You also have a beautiful view from this side. Just want to see where that snake has gone or where it's going. Oh, these snakes are so agile. I can't see it at the moment, and that's not a worry, but a little bit of a concern. I'll talk about the snake in a moment. I'm just trying to find it. Just keep a good eye out for it. You might still be able to see those owls. Where did the snake go now? Oh, there it is there. I caught it now. Okay, wow, it's incredible. Genre, we might be able to get a lovely view of it. The snake, I've got a view of the snake again. If you want to come have a look, there's beautiful light on it, just through here. At the back over there. Now this snake does hunt birds, but I think these white-faced Scops owls will be a little bit too big for it. Actually, I know they're much too big for this little Boomslang, this female Boomslang. But she will hunt chameleons, birds, and some other reptiles, but generally chameleons and birds that sit on the trees in the evenings, and they are nocturnal. And if you have a close look at the head of that Boomslang, she has got very large eyes, and that is so that she's able to see very clearly at night. Now these snakes, drop for drop, actually have the most potent venom in Africa. Now there's always a bit of a debate between this snake and obviously a black mamba in that, and the black mamba does have very potent venom, but drop for drop this is very, very powerful. But it is a hemotoxic venom, so it doesn't really affect you as quickly as a black mamba neurotoxic venom. I'll tell you the difference between the two. So hemotoxic attacks the blood, and what happens is you start to bleed internally, and it can cause severe hemorrhaging in that, and that's the Boomslang. But then the thing with the Boomslang though is that it's got a very, very small head, and it is back fanged, so the fangs sit right at the back of the mouth. So when it does bite you, if it does bite you, these snakes are actually very, very placid, and they prefer to move away from you as quickly as possible, as we could see with this tree, with the Boomslang, and getting right up into the top of the branches away from us. But if they had to bite you, they would have to try and bite generally a smaller part of your body, perhaps your arm or your hand, and they almost have to chew a little bit to work that mouth right over whatever appendage it is that they bite to inject their fangs with the venom in the back of the mouth. So it's not always a guarantee that it does bite you, for one, and if they bite you, they do have to bite you a specific way to inject the venom. But you do not want to get bitten by one of them. The other thing is I was explaining the black mamba and the difference in venom with that. The black mamba venom is neurotoxic. It attacks your nervous system. So what happens is your breathing and that your whole nervous system starts shutting down. You struggle to breathe, and that is usually what kills people very quickly if they don't receive medical attention very, very soon. Wonderful to see that worm slung. That is really, really a fantastic surprise. So, James, that worm slung, you asked how long I estimate it to be. So I think it was possibly about a meter. So if I show you, can you still see it there, Jandre? You still got it. But it's about, about a meter long. About a meter long. They can get a bit longer. Some big worm slungs, I think 1.5 to 2 meters, but I think it's about owls again. This is really incredible. They're still sitting here. They are so beautiful. The two of them. Now, the one is potentially a male and the other one a female. But I'm trying to have a look if I've got a nice view. Maybe through here, Jandre. There we go. But the other one is also maybe just a juvenile, a younger one, because it doesn't really have that large facial markings like the one on the left. But I'm not sure. It'd be interesting if that worm slung gets close to them, but I've lost it again in the tree. Oh, no, there, I've got it. It's right at the top now. Wow, that's incredible. Aubrey's helping us spot the whole time, and I can see where that snake is now. But these owls are beautiful, and thankfully they're sitting dead still, just keeping their eyes on us. But how well camouflaged are they? I mean, right in the middle of the tree. Look, if you were driving past, you definitely wouldn't see them. And that again is one of the joys of being out on the bushwalk, to be able to see animals like this. Wow, this really, I can't tell you how excited I am. It's amazing because I do love snakes. I love seeing snakes. I find them fascinating. Look, I'm very respectful of them, and I won't necessarily just try and catch a snake. There's no need for that. And usually the people who do try and handle snakes or catch snakes are the people that get bitten. But to view them and to spend time with them, if you are fortunate to, I really, really enjoy that. And then to be able to see these two owls. Twinkle Glitter, you asked how could I tell it was a female snake, and I do apologize, I should have explained that in the beginning. The females are generally brown in coloration, whereas the males can get they range in color from a brownish green, they are a lot greener, to even occasionally in some parts of the country, almost a yellow blackish color that they get on their backs. But generally the males are a lot greener, and that you can tell then it's a male, as opposed to this beautiful female, the brown female, who is still up in the top of the tree, right at the top at the moment. Just incredible how agile she is to get up there, all the way up there. It was interesting to see her behavior when she felt threatened, puffing herself up like that very, very quickly. But she's calmed down and relaxed now. I'm sure she'll probably come down and try find some food at some point during the course of the evening. And you know what? I think what we are going to do is we're going to continue on now. Don't want to disturb these owls anymore, though they seem very comfortable. But let's leave them and let them carry on resting until they start getting active a little bit later. But wasn't that fascinating? That was so exciting. And what an amazing find. Really, really great. Okay, let's head back to Jamie and get an update from her.
That is such a cool sighting, and I have to say I'm a little bit jealous of that sighting that Byron has had. I think a boomslang might be my absolute favourite snake. I think it's something to do with the eyes. I absolutely love them. Are the Great Plains of Cheetah Plains, and I thought I'd come here to see if there were any wildebeest. Unfortunately, the Great Plains of Cheetah Plains are devoid of life this afternoon. I don't know why. I don't know if it's the wind. Perhaps all of the other animals have gone into hiding. There's no sign of any wildebeest, no sign of any baby wildebeest. It is a beautiful evening, but it doesn't have any mammal life with it. Really lovely view, beautiful clouds, stunning evening, but all is quiet. Oh, thank you very much to Charlie. I was telling you about Tundi. I didn't get a chance to see her, but we could see the vehicles that were looking at her in the Mulwanini. So we couldn't, there was no way we could get a view of her. But Tundi was in what we call the Mulwanini, which is a dried up river. It's a very steep dip. We also, it's also known as Gremlin Hollow, because we don't have any signal down there. But it's one of her favorite spots. It's like the equivalent of the Mulwati or the Mulwati drainage for Karula for Tundi. And apparently she was finishing off a kill. I haven't heard anything about her, whether or not her cub was with her. I'm hoping that perhaps it was. I haven't heard any updates on that, but Tundi is happy, alive and well in the Mulwanini, snacking on something. She's got some kind of a kill with her, so she is eating. We're all happy to get any updates of Tundi. She is my favorite. You shouldn't have favorites. I really like Tundi. There's something about her that I really appreciate. And I'm hoping to have a chance to see her again. The last time I saw her cubs was before one of them was killed very sadly by the Styx lions. And it was when they were being chased by baboons. Unfortunately, I haven't had a chance. I don't think any of us have had the chance to see them since then. But I'm keeping my fingers crossed that if she's there with a kill, that perhaps maybe tomorrow morning she might decide, if it's a small kill, she might be close by, resting in the sun or something similar. I'm keeping my fingers crossed for that. Or perhaps we might even be around when she decides to move off and we'll have a chance to see her. So that was the update on Tundi. Sorry about that, I totally forgot. I got distracted by the very good question about social learning in lions. And my conclusion is there's not a huge amount of social learning that we see in a very obvious way. But they are constantly adapting to new conditions, to drought, to the rainy season, to whatever prey is available. Our Nkuhumas, of course, have been specializing in buffalo at the moment. Al-Salaam. So they've been taking full advantage of the weakened state of the buffalo. But no, I don't think there's any, that I'm aware of, any major advances in social learning. There's just so much food around. And that buffalo probably, I don't know, that could have been a lion, I suppose. But I haven't heard of any buffalo kills in this area while I've been back at work. So this probably was just a buffalo that succumbed to the drought and has been finished off by hyenas and vultures. So they really have been in very poor condition. Luckily, it seems as though the rains have arrived at just the right moment. The grass is looking greener, much, much greener, and not just on the other side, but all around the grass is greener. Well, we've been talking a little bit about diseases, and we might as well, while we're chatting, we might as well have a nice animal to have a look at, since these impala are here. Oh, or not. Or we could be running away. But Pat, you wanted to know if the animals can get epilepsy in the same way that domestic animals can. I don't know the answer to that question. I have absolutely no idea. I've never encountered any examples of epilepsy in wild animals. I suspect that if it did occur, it is a genetic fault that would have been bred out, just due to the fact that it would have made survival of those animals incredibly difficult, particularly for things that are... There's an ox picker hanging onto that impala right at its belly. Particularly for things like leopards that are solitary creatures, if they were struck by epilepsy, it would make them incredibly vulnerable in those moments. And I think that quite a lot of epilepsy is within domestic animals, I imagine, particularly within dogs and cats, can be caused by, if not necessarily a lot of inbreeding, poor genetics and possibly other diseases that might have struck them. But I'm not sure. I really honestly don't know. I have heard of inbreeding in lions causing disorders like epilepsy, dwarfism. It is after a few generations of inbreeding, lions do start to show severe effects of that sort of thing, which is why, of course, as brutal as it is, the male takeovers are so necessary. But whether or not an impala would have epilepsy, I don't know. I've never seen it. It does make me wonder whether the other animals would pick up on it. Like if it was a herd animal, like an impala, if it started to have epileptic fits or epileptic episodes, would the other animals shun it? Quite possibly. Animals tend to have a very good instinct for that sort of thing and for illness, and they obviously don't understand what it is. But if any of you have any knowledge of epilepsy in wild animals, I would love to hear about it. As always, you can send that through the normal channels on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. And maybe Brent knows something more, or Byron might know something more about epilepsy in wild animals. I don't. I can't think of an example where I've heard of it happening. It's hard to imagine. It's particularly when you start thinking of the larger animals, something like an elephant, it would probably be very dangerous, or a giraffe. Very, very dangerous for them. So no, I'm not sure. But a very good question. We've had some lovely questions coming through this afternoon, and thank you to all of you for sending them through. VM, have you ever heard of epilepsy in wild animals? No, I haven't. Not our wild animals, anyway. I mean, obviously I'm no expert into wild animals outside of Africa. No, I don't think so. I think it's a gene that would be relatively unlikely to express itself out here. It would be very rare if in fact it does exist or occur. Fascinating. Oh, no sign of any wildebeest on the great open areas of Cheetah Plains. I'm a little bit disappointed. I know that Byron had new baby wildebeest calves, and that's one of my favorite things. I absolutely love little baby wildebeest. They're so entertaining. They're as entertaining, if not more entertaining, than the little baby impala. Oh, shame. This old marula tree, every time I pass it, makes me a little bit sad, because it is slowly but surely, it's dead, and slowly but surely rotting away. Branch by branch is falling off, and that's why you've got to be very careful climbing on top of old and rotten marulas. Marula wood is very, very soft, which means that it is easy for the termites and the wood borers to eat, and it does end up eventually crumbling and collapsing. But that old, it was a big marula tree, would have been many years old. Now I've got to dodge around this. So our last plan for Cheetah Plains, since there's no sign of any cheetah and there's no sign of any wildebeest, and I'm a little bit nervous this marula is going to fall onto our heads. There we go. Would have been very unlucky if it had. I think we're going to go and check Juma Dam to see if there is any sign of the sticks. And I'm laughing just because Rebecca pointed out that at least we've done our first aid drill this morning, where Brent had to pretend that he'd fallen off the vehicle and he was concussed, or at least he'd had a head injury and a potential neck injury and some broken ribs and one broken leg. He was a very noisy patient. And quite a Pardon?
The chirpy as well for somebody that
broke the leg. Oh, yeah, yeah. No, he did. He did give us the odd chirp. This isn't the first time that Brent has been the guinea pig. The last time it was a fake snake bite. And we laugh and we joke about these things, but they are, of course, incredibly important for us. And to just keep in our minds and keep refreshed the lessons that we've learned in terms of first aid and treating situations like that. Just because we are quite... Oh, goodness. More marula. We are quite far from medical facilities. So it is important that we have those lessons in mind. If, for example, Byron had perhaps lost his mind and decided to try and catch that boomslang, for example, and she'd bitten him. Although boomslangs, you're okay. You're not okay, you're going to be very ill, but you're okay in terms of time period. You've got a good few hours to get that person to hospital before the hemotoxic venom starts to act on your system. A mamba, on the other hand, is a completely different story. While I travel all the way to Juma Dam on Cheetah Plains, which is a bit confusing for those of you that are new, let us go all the way to Juma and onto the great open area of quarantine.
Well, we've decided to come play with the baby impalas because they make us happy. So I'm just trying to find the big group of baby impalas. I can see a couple around here at the fireside chat spot. Hello, little one. Now, at this time of the day, they quite often get very playful, so that's what we're hoping for. Some of them might still be a bit young, and we're also hoping that the impala's keen senses will spot a leopard. Now, see what that one, look how this one's looking. Now, to the left, look at both of them, they're looking intently at something. Unfortunately, they have not spotted Krula, but I think we should hit what they spotted with a stick, because it's now chasing our impalas away. Do you see what the impalas have spotted?
I do.
You see what they have spotted. Again, they thwart us. Look at them, they don't know they're on air. Ah, look at them, they don't even... Oh, there we go, now they realize they chased our impalas. Wow, tusk, tusk, chasing our impalas. Look how the impalas are staring at them. They're looking at... They don't like Jandre and Byron, do they? And look at them. They're giving them the evil eye. That is the impala equivalent of the evil eye. But they're like, okay, we don't like those guys, but they're not that scary. We don't need to snort at them. They're not Karula. I was wondering why that impala was looking so intently to the west. Yes, run away from them, little one. Behind the gardenia that has been massacred by the elephants. It's amazing how quick and nimble they are from such a young age. Oh, off they go. Well, we have no... Oh, there goes the last of them. Bye, impalas. I suppose we better go find a cat now. Hey, Brian. Well, might as well. Let's go see if we can keep... We're going to keep checking for Karula for now. We have checked all the common haunts, but alas. So they've dashed off. Now, sorry, I thought I saw something there. But now, let's go find out from Bushwalk what their excuse is for chasing our impala.
I'm so sorry, Brett. We didn't mean to chase the impala. We didn't know they were out in the clearing on that side. I'm sure they'll settle back down again soon. We had such a wonderful bushwalk this afternoon. I really hope you all enjoyed it as much as we have. It's been fantastic, and a big thank you to all of you for your questions and comments. It's been great. Thank you to Aubrey, who was joining us this afternoon, and then Jandre, thank you very much, as always, on camera. And from myself, Byron, it's been a great afternoon. Enjoy the rest of the drive, and we'll see you all tomorrow. Goodbye, everyone.
Last station, who are you looking for? Ooh, what have we spotted? There we go. I'm just going to be on the radio for a second, but do you see that bird there? Not that I heard of, James. Oh, that is not what I actually spotted, but well spotted, Brian. Indeed, that is the lilac-breasted Rola, the resident pair on quarantine. What I was looking at was the cuckoo, who's hanging around the Rola, probably trying to get a chance to get into that Rola's nest. Now, if we come across to the left of the dead tree, so where the biggest thick branch on the dead tree is, there we go. Zoom in up to the top. There we go. A little bit to the right. A little bit down. There, oh, there he goes. It was a Le Valence cuckoo. Oh, where's it going? High speed. Was it Le Valence or Jacobin? Turn to us. No, it's Le Valence. You see the stripy throat. Now, lilac-breasted rollers do fall within their brood parasites. There we go. So the rollers have to keep a close lookout for those cuckoos who will kick their eggs out of their nest and lay their own. And you can see they are a similar size, even though that they're quite far away. Lovely shot, Brian. Oh, there he goes. Oh, yeah, a little interesting. So there we go. The Rola better be careful with brood parasites around, that it doesn't end up raising someone else's babies. Yes, I already forgot. You were chatting about epilepsy in wild animals with Jamie, and Jamie pretty much covered it all from what Final Control swallowed. It is very unusual due to genetics in wild animals and the fact that they don't inbreed too often. And if an animal does become epileptic, it's normally abandoned by the pride, the herd, the mother, and it will be left to die. Sorry, I've got alarm calls. Where are they looking? Is this Queen Karula around? We have been looking for her. Paula is snorting. I can't see a general direction. It sounds like they might be snorting a little bit further up. Now they are quite jumpy with young around. Now they didn't hang around, they snorted and ducked. Now this Nyala is, I'm not sure what's going on. See, that's why you trust an Nyala and you trust a kudu. They confirm, they check before they start barking. Whereas impalas sometimes they'll just get a whiff of a predator and start alarming, even though the predator might be long gone. Well, let's just go look towards where the Nyala was looking and the impala moved away from. Could it be the queen we've been searching so diligently for? We're looking sort of towards this area here. Strange enough, this is the exact area Brian and I were planning to come check next. Now this green flush has made spotting a little bit more difficult than when there were no leaves anywhere. Okay. Now this is an area Karula has been known to utilize extensively and also disappear into extensively. It is quite a thick area. We have spotted her from camp on many occasions down. So there's the DRC. Can see our our new fancy satellite dish. Look at that, isn't that snazzy, Brian? It's amazingly snazzy. Okay. Come on, Queen Karula, wouldn't it be a lovely afternoon treat for the killer bees on their first day reunited? Maybe she's heading towards Galagopan. Guinea fowls alarm calling as well. Now, the problem with guinea fowls at this time of the year is quite often they're arguing over ladies. But let's get in there a little bit quicker. Silence now. Let's keep checking. Those guinea fowls sound like they could have been anywhere from here. The Galagopan is literally just through this thicket here. Unfortunately, it's too thick to take a vehicle straight through, so we're going to have to go the long way around. Okay, we're going to scour the landscape. Hopefully our luck is changing and the killer bees will be on fire yet again. Actually, we're always on fire. But in the meantime, let's go see what's happening at Juma Dam with Jamie.
We'll keep our fingers crossed for the killer bees. In the meantime, we have arrived at Juma Dam, the great and flourishing waterhole, or what little water there is here, which is of course one of the favorite places of the Styx females. We saw two so days in a row, we were able to see the Styx female with her two brand new tiny fluffy little cubs hiding in the sort of the outflow of where this waterhole leads to, which is into a drainage line off sort of at the top part of the dam. I haven't seen any sign of her. There's no tracks or anything of the sort. They have reconstructed Juma Dam, as you can see. It's been a work in progress, and they very kindly placed logs on the wall of the dam to make sure that nobody drives there, in order to make sure it doesn't get damaged in any way whilst everything sort of solidifies and settles. Unfortunately, one of those logs really, really looked like a lion. From all the way back along the road that side, I really thought we were about to come around the corner and find the Styx lioness sitting on the dam wall. It was most devastating to discover that she was not there. Then I got there and there's a beautiful, nice, tan, lion-coloured rock. But that's definitely not lion-shaped at all. But out of the corner of your eye, it could have been. Okay, it doesn't look so tan, actually. But fair enough. And we're just going to dip through the dam and out onto the other side. Our signal should be fine. Our signal should be fine. We might lose communication just as we go through, but we should be fine on the other side. Jerry apparently says that the logs look a lot like crocodiles rather than lions. That one definitely does. That one looks like a very long crocodile. The one on the right there. That longish one. That could be a crocodile.
A logodile.
We found a logodile, everybody. We don't really see crocodiles here, so a logodile is about as close as we're going to get. Until there is slightly more river. Slightly more river? That's not a word. Slightly more water in the dam. Okay, just hold on. We're going to skip through very quickly. Right, let's try and rephrase that. A crocodile is not an animal that we see all that frequently until we have more water in the dams, not until we have more river in the... I don't know what I was trying to say there. Okay, So no luck this afternoon, apart from, of course, our lovely Birmingham boy, the one that we don't often get to see. But no luck on Cheetah Plains. Although, night's not yet over. Who knows what we might bump into on our way home. But a 30-minute long serval sighting once on Cheetah Plains. I'm still hopeful for something thoroughly exciting and entertaining. There's no lion tracks around here. They could just be a little bit to the west of where we are now on a property known as the Nets, which is just outside of our traverse area and also one of their preferred spots. So she might have taken the cubs that way. I'm not going to go digging into the drainage line though to see if I can find her, at least not on foot. She's quite a skittish lioness and we don't want to startle her with young cubs. And the Styx Pride, for those of you that are new to these safaris, moves all the way from Cheetah Plains right onto Juma. So they do have a large, as all lion prides do, they have a large home range, but they do tend to spend most of their time between Cheetah Plains and Koror and then Annette's just off to the west of us. But unfortunately today, the combination of wet soil and also potentially the fact that they aren't here, but it has made tracking them relatively tricky. I thought I'd tell you a funny story just by the way. Hold on, let's hear this first. And first, they said that Yay, Leafery Falsus. And Fast says, can we please look for the birds because they love them? Yes, we can work Leafery Fools. I also really love the birds. Yes, we can look for them. With pleasure, we can look for them. One of the birds that I really want to see, because this morning, this afternoon, just before we started the pre-show, we saw a red-crested Korhan do its flight display. And there are so many red-crested Korhans on Cheetah Plains, and I haven't seen one today, but it's obviously their breeding season, so I'm quite upset that I haven't had a chance to see them. Well, you've already seen white-faced scopsowls, apparently, with Byron, in a place that I... That's a lovely bird to see. Okay, we found some impala instead. Some female impala, but I don't think that counts. Hello, ladies. Ooh, some very heavy pregnant bellies at the moment. Not many babies on Cheetah Plains, conversely. Oh, there's some birds, and they're having a dust bath. Sorry, in the middle of... There's a baby. Oh, it's about to interrupt the birds. There we go. Some crested Franklin having a really lovely dust bath. Doesn't that look like fun? No, don't go. Don't go. Finish your bath. It's okay. A little puff of dust. Oh, that was terribly sweet. So the Franklin dust bathing as a way of essentially cleaning their feathers it's like exfoliating, essentially. So rather than having a quick bath, dust bathing is exfoliating the feathers. So the grains of the sand and the dirt scratch in between probably feel really nice for those Franklin. And at the same time, catch and get rid of all of those mites and parasites that might be building up on them. Especially after a day spent wandering through long grass. That was a nice, rare opportunity to see birds doing what they do best, which is having a dust bath. We should go and have a look. I'm going to go and have a look and see that track, but I don't want to move because apparently our signal is a little bit shaky. So let's keep watching the impala for now. Our lovely, very large ladies. It is interesting that Cheetah Plains saw the first wildebeest births, and yet they seem to be relatively behind in terms of impala birth. And that happens. You get places where the birth starts, obviously, you get slight, just a couple of days, couple of weeks variation between the different parts of this reserve in terms of when the animals start to give birth. All of these females, though, especially the one we're looking at, are imminent. The births are imminent. Fluffy tails are still wagging away. We're going to extricate ourselves from the signal black hole that we seem to be about to enter. While we do, let's travel all the way back across to Juma.
Welcome back. Where Brian and I going? There's no road in front of us. Brian, where are we going? Oh dear. I think I even lost where we're supposed to be going. I wonder what could be here. Yes, no, we went the wrong way. Brian, why weren't you looking? Yeah. So we are off the road. We're heading towards a creature. And what creature it is, I wonder. Well, of course, I don't wonder. Brian, do you wonder?
No.
No, we know what it is. But you don't. Remember, this is 100% live, and you can send us questions using the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, or you can pop us an email to questions@wildearth.tv. And there is a creature. Does that look like one or two creatures? Just one. Oh dear. Hello, Mr. Creature. Here we go. Hello, it looks like Mr. Tino lazing about. One station with Wanunangala off Central Road, Vietela. Look at him. Hello, mister. Your belly still looks quite full from the buffalo you were eating yesterday morning. Well, nice overcast afternoon, so he hasn't had to lie in the shade of a big tree. Sorry guys, I've just got to try help someone on the radio for a second. Standing by. Well, we wait to chat to them. Oh, there we go. Afermian, it's Brent. So Richard was wondering, does male lion mane colour make a difference? Richard, I will be with you in 1 second. Afermian. Copy. Now, Richard, that's a really good question. So there has been quite a bit of different research into the mane color, and it seems that the darker the mane, the higher the testosterone level. And in certain parts of Africa, it seems that females are attracted to that. Now, as with a lot of things out in the African bushes, there's no steadfast rule, because as we've noticed in the last while, the most dominant male lion that's been within the Birmingham boys has been Mfumo, the authority, and he's kept Tinyo at bay. And then, well, if Tsuko's down on cheetah plans, I'm guessing the one we saw yesterday was Nena. So he has kept them both at bay, keeping Amber Eyes shielded from the other males, so he gets the first opportunity to mate with her. So in certain circumstances, yes, the darker the mane means more testosterone, and theoretically females prefer males with darker manes, and males are more scared of males with darker manes. But the authority of Mfumo doesn't have as dark a mane as Tinyo here. But I also think Mfumo's a little bit younger. And I don't think the Birmingham boys are all the same age. And just looking at Tinyo's mane and some of the scars and nicks in his ears and that, I'd say he's possibly even a year older than the authority. Now, maybe the exuberance of youth is playing a role in him being more dominant, but as if you look at the Mapochos, I mean, there were five males there, and often in the interactions that I personally saw in the Southern Sabi Sands, the most dominant was Mr. T, even though he had the least impressive mane, and he was physically smaller than the other guys, but he was the most aggressive. So quite often, I think attitude goes a long way. Very quiet evening. All the flies upon him. Hi, Daniel. And he's in Scotland. Daniel would like to know, have we ever seen all the Birmingham boys on one drive? Indeed we have. Quite a few times in the early days. There used to be five of them. And we actually have seen all five together on quite a few occasions. The last time we saw all five together was on Sandy Patch in the sunset. It was quite a spectacular sight as they walked alongside us with the sun setting beyond them. Obviously since then, one Birmingham boy has moved to the great hunting field in the sky. He died eventually from injuries he sustained from a buffalo hunt. It looked like a buffalo horn punctured his lung. It unfortunately did take him quite a while to die. But it is a hard life for male lions. I mean, it is a really, really tough life. And male lions always full of holes, scars, bites, scratches, ticks, biting flies. Which you can see. Oh! I heard quite a funny comment from one of the final control girls when they saw a lion do that. It's like when you need to give yourself a hug. I'd never thought of it like that before, but of course he's just stretching, but it does look like he might be giving himself a hug. Now he looks very, very content, not like he's about to move. About to move any time soon. Now, the great thing about having four male lions in a coalition, or even more, is the massive amount of area they can cover. So, I mean, we've got one male down on Cheetah Plains, which is, sure, probably as the crow flies, 10, 12, maybe 15 kilometers. And I'm sure Mfumo is around here somewhere. And then Nena could be in Buffalo's Hook somewhere. So that they're able to maintain dominance over a large area and by vocalization, by scent marking. And those vocalizations carry. I mean, a male lion can probably hear another one from about 20 kilometers. So if they ever get into trouble, reinforcements are just a roar away. Now, Dark Princess is wondering about the predator's smell, and she's wondering, do some predators smell more than others? And we did have those impala alarm calling haphazardly, half-heartedly a little earlier. Now, she's wondering, do some predators smell more, that the prey species will alarm more and know that they're there? I wouldn't say so. I mean, let's be completely honest. Lions, leopards, hyenas, wild dogs, cheetah, none of them smell particularly pleasant. And I'd say out of all of those, you probably find the worst smelling lions by a long way. Yes, they're very smelly cats. But again, the most prey species will rely mostly on sight. So till they can see it for definite, then they start alarm calling incessantly. Smell doesn't actually play that bigger role. Sight and hearing, so hearing something that they're uncomfortable with or actually seeing a predator is what will set them off. Now, This big boy is not moving very much, so it is your game drive after all, so it's up to you. Should we spend some more time with the sleeping Tino the Tooth, or should we carry on meandering to see what else we can find? Let me know by using the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. There's going to be a poll created by Final Control, so you can let us know whether we should hang out with a Tino for a bit longer, or should we go see if we can find some other interesting things. Yes, I don't think he looks like he's going to move or roar before the end of drive. He is quite, I suppose, you've heard us all say it a lot of time, but he is a very flat cat. Now, Liss is wondering, is Tinio about the same age as Amber Eyes? And Liss, if I had to tell you, I would be lying. I'd say he's probably, I'm guessing he's 6.5, 7. I'm not actually sure on Amber Eyes' age. She was an adult lioness when I arrived here. And so I couldn't say whether she's older, younger, in between. She's an adult, though. That I'm quite sure of. Now, with adult lionesses, unless you've known them for a long time, it is quite difficult. So there we go. Apparently, she is 6. And so it's about the same age then, maybe a little bit younger. You must remember, the Birmingham boys spent their time marauding up north before becoming resident down here. And they had a good couple of years by themselves before they became pride males, dominating over 3 prides. Hi, Adam in Alabama, who's a brand new viewer, so a massive Safari Live welcome to you, Adam. Really great to have you on the back of the largest game drive vehicle in the world. Now, Adam's question is, any of the animals that we see showed aggression towards us? Occasionally, Adam, but generally if an animal shows aggression towards us, we'll move away. With the lions and leopards, not too often. Sometimes with ellies, if ellies are uncomfortable, we'll move away. We never want to put ourselves in a position where the animal feels so uncomfortable that they need to get overly aggressive with us. So we are very careful about that and try and move away as soon as there is any sign of that. And it's very important to remember, as long as you drive and treat these animals with respect, and you're going to be okay. But as soon as you start pushing their boundaries, are you asking for trouble? These are wild animals. This is the middle of the bush, so don't be naughty. There we go, he moved his tail. A very sleepy kitty. Still digesting the buffalo. There you go. Still got quite a nice full belly, so not hungry. Tina would like to know, would a coalition member kill another member of the coalition? I mean, it's possible if they get into a very, very serious fight over females, but it's very unlikely. I haven't heard of a coalition member killing another coalition member. But it might have happened. As I said, there's no fixed and set rule with these animals. So the moment you start dealing in concrete, you get jackhammered. Well, I thought that was quite clever. What do you think, Brian? Do you like that one, Brian? I saw Brian started smiling, yes. So, I mean, anything is possible, Tina. It's one thing you ought to remember. These animals are incredible, and they, of course, don't read all the books we write about them, so they're quite capable of proving us wrong at any time. So I definitely wouldn't rule it out, but I would say it would be an uncommon behavior. And see, as it gets cooler, the biting flies decrease in number. So it gives a lot of the animals respite for the evening from the irritating bites of the stable flies. although it seems like Tenyo is a Zen master. He's managed to find enlightenment and ignore the flies completely. So, the poll has spoken. And we're going to leave him now and go see what else we can find. Okay. So we're going to make our way out. We'll leave Mr. Tenyo to his slumber. Now, there he is. For those of you who watched the Juma Dam camp, and you must keep a listen out tonight, because I think they're going to be quite vocal. Now, I'm just going to get a road marker. There we go. That's my road sign to leave on the road for the next person coming in so they can find Mr. Tenyo. Now, I'm pretty sure Mfumo and Amber Eyes are somewhere to the north of the Vuyatela Dam, but we just couldn't find them. And it is a very big area there without any roads. So we did have a good look, but they might get moving. I think Amber Eyes is still desperately trying to get back towards the rest of the pride. And although I'm not sure, did you see them mating? Have, if we've seen them mating, then maybe she will be with them for a few more days. But I haven't seen them mate yet, so it'll be interesting to see what happens. But good news, while I place my road sign, Jamie has made it back to Juma in one piece.
We have made it back onto Juma without any assistance from any road signs. But I should hope not. It's not a very difficult journey to make. And now we're heading into the evening to see what mysterious nocturnal creatures we can find. And it's just right at that point where a spotlight doesn't quite help you. It's just in the next 2 minutes the spotlight will be helpful. But right now, all it serves to really do is highlight the bushes and nothing else behind them or in them. We're trundling along the southern boundary of Juma, just waiting to see what we can see, really. I've seen Jennet on my road home from Cheetah Plains before. I've seen Serval. Now, there's all kinds of things that might decide to pop out. Oh, by the way, I did want to show you the viewers, the tracks that the Franklin made in the dirt. Unfortunately, they weren't clear at all. Plus, a whole load of impala had marched on top of them. So that combination in this light, I did try and take a photo for you, but in this light and on an evening like this evening with the dark, with the sun setting and the clouds, it just didn't come out at all. I'm sorry. I will look for another place where birds have dust bathed, perhaps tomorrow on the sunrise safari, and I'll see if I can't get you a much nicer looking track. Sorry about that. I did try, but it was just, I think I was a little overly ambitious with the amount of light that we had. I did try though. It basically just looks like a little scuffed basin. It's just a little depression in the earth, and you can see the bird's claws, and you can see where they've fluffed their feathers and the dust has gone flying in every which direction. Okay, let's see. It would be very funny if we bumped into Karula on our way home, and entirely possible as well. Although I think that the killer bees might be a little bit upset with us if we did. But let us see how we go. Now I'm hoping, since Byron's had a boomslang, perhaps we might manage with a chameleon. Or one of the nocturnal species of snake would also be very nice. One of the blind snakes, perhaps. There's quite a few nocturnal or snakes that come out at night. And even some of the diurnal ones are still around and about at this time of evening. And it's nice and cool after a hot day, because in summer, of course, being ectothermic, they can overheat. Not overheat, but they have to find shade when it does get too hot. But this evening's the perfect temperature for an ectothermic snake to wander about. Let's see. This is where I saw the genet the last time. It was somewhere around here. And they often reuse the same little secret nesting places. But I don't see any sign of them. I happen to be, just by the way, while we're driving around at night, and I'm thinking of it, after I finished my walk a couple of days ago, after I finished my walk a couple of days ago, I did happen to be in final control when Karula popped out and surprised Byron. And she really did pop out and surprise him. He stopped to look at an impala, and this leopard just, I don't know, she just glided out of the bushes right next to him. Hello. I saw movement. Sorry, Vim, I'm gonna have to go forward a little bit for you. Oh, there we go. No, it's fine. The little scrub hair. His movement just caught my eye. And that fluffy mixed coat of greys and blacks and browns makes for perfect camouflage during the day. And they sit completely still, hidden beneath dense vegetation. Oh, he's got a hole in his ear, I just noticed briefly. But they will sit completely still in dense vegetation, and much like the lizard earlier with Byron, a surprise scrub hare jumping out of the bushes next to you can give you quite the fright. And they'll be out looking for grazing opportunities. And of course, practice what's known as coprophagy. Unlike most of our other herbivores, they have a relatively simple digestive tract, and as a result, he's hopped away by the way, as a result, in order to digest their food, they can't do it with a four-chambered stomach like our ruminants. They have to essentially digest their food once, excrete it, defecate it out, and eat their defecation again. And that's how they go about really getting the nutrients that they need. And you'll also see little baby antelope do it as well, and baby zebra, and baby elephant, and hippo. A lot of baby animals will do it as a way of getting the enzymes and the antibodies that they need from their moms. Alice! He wants to know whether or not we've had any slithery friends in our house lately. It's actually been surprisingly quiet on that front. We had one large snake, we don't know what it was, one large snake slithered away from us as we arrived one night to get back home. As we pulled into the driveway and as we parked the car, there was a very large snake that slithered away. It could have been any number of things. It could have been the big scary ones like a mamba or a cobra, or it could have been a large, I don't think it was a large house snake, it was too large for that. But it was quite a big snake. I know that Alex this morning, was it this morning only? No, it was yesterday morning. It was yesterday morning. Yesterday morning we had the tiger snake in the cam ops room, which is where all of our cameras and equipment is stored. There was a tiger snake in there. I believe that one was caught by Steph. And then shortly afterwards, Rebecca, just remind me, how did that tiger snake come to be found again? Did it slither across your foot or something? Rebecca says that both she and Gert were in the cam ops room at the time, and that they got such a big fright, or skrikt, as we say in South African colloquialism. They skrikt so hard that they screamed and it wasn't audible because they got such a fright it was too high pitched. I think I would have paid money to see Gert leap that high into the air though. It would have been thoroughly entertaining. So a little tiger snake, they are mildly venomous, not dangerous to humans, but they are mildly venomous. And then Alex sent through a picture of what's known as a variegated bush snake that was hiding out in one of the boxes below the dam camera that he was busy working on. I don't know whether he ever managed to extricate that snake or if it moved. Oh no, he did say it moved away. He did tell me it moved away from, ow, bug to the ear. It moved away from that area. So we've had one or two, luckily not as bad as last year's cobra in the kitchen, or last wet season's cobra in the kitchen. That was an interesting one. We never found that cobra, despite best efforts. But it is the start of yet more things to come. Quite a few scorpions. Sorry, I did see something here. I think it was a little dacre though, and it appears to be gone. No. Nope. And I think if I'm not very much mistaken, that about covers our snake encounters for this wet season. But let's head across to Brent so that he can confirm that absolutely is the case.
Well, I don't know if Jamie remembered the Connor's snake sighting. Final Control will tell me now. It was quite an amusing one. Oh, hello. Well, I'll tell you about it once we have a look at this little birdie in the road. Now, for the birders, we haven't had a chance to look at nightjars for a while. Now, they are incredibly difficult to ID because they all are sort of that mottled brown color. Now, quite often you want to try ID them based on where you are sitting. And you see that massive eye. Let me get the nightjars out. Now, in our area, we've got the two main vocal nightjars are the fiery-necked nightjar and the square-tailed nightjar. Of course, both of them have reddish necks. just to confuse. Now, quite often, one of the more difficult things with them. Where's the fiery-necked nightjar? Sorry. You want to look at the wings, and obviously, when they're not flying, it's quite difficult. Ooh, we can hear it calling. Now, if this one responds, oh, he leapt after a bird. Oh, but then yeah, that gives us a much better view. I'm going to put the other spotlight on for you, Brian. So we're looking at that around the throat is an easy way, because that fiery neck is not a good indicator. Generally, we're looking around the neck for the white there. Now, again, both species have white, but we're also looking at the wing shoulder. Because the wing shoulder has no white on it, and we've got that little white dot under the throat, and it's not too prominent, and he's got quite a gray head. So we are looking at a male fiery necked nightjar here. Now, as I said, they can be extremely difficult. Let me just rephrase. We're looking at a very full male fiery neck nightjar. Look how full his crop is. He's been eating all the bugs. Brian will be very happy, because otherwise the bugs land on Brian. Here we go. A male fiery necked nightjar. Now, let's switch off the lights so when we go past, he can escape us. Now, Jamie did forget one snake sighting, which is possibly the most amusing snake sighting of the year. We were all sitting around the fire, conversing, obviously very intelligent, deep conversations, as all the Wild Earth staff do around the fire. No nonsense talk whatsoever. And I was sitting next to Connor and James Connor, and discussing very deep and meaningful things. Connor, I thought, fell off his chair, and he leapt without a word through his chair. We thought he fell off and jumped 2 meters back, and then went, "Oh, snake!" But no, it didn't warn any of us till he was well clear of the firing zone. and it was very amusing. And shame, it turned out to be a little East African, East African shovel snout. Very pretty little harmless snake that I put a video up of that snake on my Instagram if you want to have a look. It's a very, very beautiful little snake, a very harmless snake, normally lives underground, eats things like slugs and snails and lizard eggs, actually, and snake eggs are one of its favorite things. So completely harmless to us. That was another snake sighting this year. And then of course VM and I had one on drive of a black mamba on quarantine being mobbed by starlings, and I think that wraps up all the snakes for the year. Now the one thing we have not seen a lot of this year is chameleons. Brian seems to think he's going to find one tonight.
He will.
Will you find one before the end of drive? Is the question. Okay. Where would you like me to drive to find you a chameleon?
Back towards camp.
Back towards camp. Okay. Let's see if Brian's chameleon spotting skills are on form this evening. Plane expert, who's a new viewer, said had so much fun on last night's drive and decided to come back. Well, welcome back. I hope you've had fun on this drive as well. As we're searching for chameleons at the moment, of course we wouldn't say no to a leopard that stepped out in front of us, but our main aim of the game, because Brian is convinced he's going to find a chameleon, so I will drive wherever he wants to find a chameleon. So we're coming up to a T-junction, Brian. Would you like to go straight towards the Vuyatela Pan, or would you like to go left past Ingers in your chameleon search?
To the left.
To the left. Okay. So we'll go to the left past Ingers. If I was looking for chameleons, I would have gone straight, but it's not me. It's Brian. So if we don't find any chameleons, it's not my fault. Aha. Here we go. No sign of any chameleons just yet. Oh, impala. Now, we're looking in trees that chameleons like, gwarries and buffalo thorns, and the impala have passed. It's on with the lights again. And that, it has rained two nights in a row. Not much rain, but will that be enough to bring the chameleons out? Not in that bush. Have I found a chameleon, Brian? Was that just a funny shaped leaf? Or is it a moth? If it is a chameleon, it's the most minute chameleon in the world. You see that there? What is that?
That yellow spot
there? Yeah, it's a dry leaf. It's a dry leaf, alas. Not a chameleon. It's not a moth, it's a dry leaf. The last dry leaf left on the gorry bush. Okay. No signs yet of any chameleons. Oh, Brian, we're running out of time. Uh-oh. We've got to go across to Jamie. Will Jamie beat the killer bees in the chameleon hunt? Let's find out.
Brent has no need to be nervous, I'm afraid to say. I've got nothing. Although I have a feeling that Rebecca might have made him think that I do. I have not yet found a chameleon. I did, however, also find a very strange leaf. So, of course, we're looking for the slightly lighter coloured chameleons. They go white at night because there's no point to them being any other colour, because not much can see in colour at night. So they go a light colour that stands out very, very clearly. But unfortunately, clearly is all relative. And I haven't seen one chameleon this season. Starting to feel somewhat bereft. I'm going very, very, very slowly. And the nice thing about looking for chameleons is the things you find at the same time while you're searching. Nope. either the smallest chameleon in the world, or it's a moth. Or it's a leaf.
It's a flower.
It's a flower! Oh, almost. Almost, but not quite. No, no, I didn't make a bet on that one, Rebecca. A chameleon tip jar. Every time we think we've seen a chameleon, we have to put 10 rand into a tip jar. I think that's quite a good idea. First one to see an actual one gets the jar. I like that. False alarms equal 10 rand. And then whoever sees the first one. So the longer we go actually without seeing one, with more false alarms, the better. And then we'll, whoever gets the one will earn a huge amount of money. Not a huge amount of money. Might feel like a victory though. Have a false spot penalty jar. I like that, VM. It's a good idea. Except now I have to pay 10 rand, but so does Brent. And my other one doesn't count because I wasn't live. So it doesn't count as a false chameleon. Luckily we've got the gentle squeaking of Jigger as we travel very slowly. Squeak, 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 squeak. Hey Jigger, it's good to have you back out of your time of confinement. We got many spider webs. Ah, yes, actually, because VM was busy working in the back of Jigger, and he apparently found many, many spider webs in the back. So Jigger's basically been gathering cobwebs and dust over the last few weeks. So it's good to have her back in action, even if she is a little squeaky. Come on, chameleon. I'm basically, we could walk home faster, although we wouldn't because it is dark and that's dangerous. But that's how keen I am to spot the chameleon. Oh no, we are out of time and time has run out and it's time to say farewell to you all. So sadly we'll have to say goodbye and resume the chameleon search tomorrow. But from VM and myself, well actually a big thank you to VM first of all, and to all of the rest of the crew and to you, I hope you have a wonderful day and we'll see you tomorrow. Bye bye everybody.
No chameleons yet. Oh deary me. We do have two secret spots to check. Now, last rainy season, you know what I think? The elephants have moved the secret spot, Brian. They have. It's gone. So this branch used to be much bigger and go across the road, and we often used to find a chameleon in it, but the elephants, I forgot about that, have trimmed the chameleon branch. Okay, well, we haven't given up yet. Well, if we can't find them out in the bush, let's look closer to home. We have found chameleons in these buffalo thorns right outside camp many times. No! Ryan, why did you put so much pressure on us?
Don't buckle under the pressure.
Don't buckle. 1 minute, don't 30 buckle. Seconds. Oh no, waterbucks, I apologize. Come on, chameleon. Come on, chameleon. Oh dear. I think we might have to say it's a draw. No one found a chameleon. Sharon thinks the false chameleon should be ordained as a new wild earth species. Well, I don't think I'm going to let that. It has to be a real one. What do you think, Brian?
It has to be a real one.
It has to have oscillating eyes. But it's nearly the end of drive. We've had lots of fun with you all today, and don't forget, we're going to be doing it again in a few short hours, and we look forward to having you on the back. And as always, Brian, so good, killer bees back, and to all of us, from all of us at Wild Earth, thanks very much, and we'll see you bright and early in the morning. No.